Okay, I'm going to call the March 13th Issaquah City Council Committee work session to order. Welcome, everybody. The first item on the agenda is Agenda Bill 7304, Downtown Streetscape Plan, presented by Andrea Snyder. Hi.
So thank you for having us here tonight. We are very excited to show you what the Streetscape Plan has come to so far. First, I'm going to provide a little bit of background, explain why we got here, talk about some of the goals for today. And then Ida and Leslie, who are on the city's design team, will talk about each of the concepts and different parts of the projects and explain some of the public feedback as well. So first goal for tonight is to show you the plan and offer the opportunity for you to provide feedback on the plan so far, the draft plan, I should say, and provide feedback and for you to ask questions while we have our consultant team here as well. And we will also be seeking some guidance on areas where we may have received some mixed feedback. I will also be highlighting some policy level issues for discussion tonight. What we will not be doing tonight, not part of our goals for tonight, are we won't be fixing traffic. So the city's already doing a number of things, as I think you know, for us to address the traffic issue. The Streetscape Plan really aims to make Front Street and the downtown a better environment once you've gotten out of your car, not necessarily for while you're still in it. And I bring that up because it was something that came up a couple of times in the open houses and through public feedback. So I just wanted to make sure that was clear for those watching at home that we will not be addressing traffic tonight. And then the second thing we will not be doing tonight is we will not be discussing project costs, the phasing or proposed phasing of any of the projects. And we will not be talking about funding mechanisms. This is something that we hope to do next time we come to council, which is in April. So that discussion is being reserved for until we have a final concept. Right now, what you're going to be seeing is really an iteration. It's the latest of the iterations that the public also got to see for the open house that we just did 2 days ago on Saturday. All right, so like I said, tonight is a check-in, but first let's talk about how we got here. In 2015, there was a city council goal for establishing the Old Town Vitality Task Force, whose mission was to provide recommendations on things that the community can do together to enhance Old Town's vitality and the downtown's vitality. And so they had a number of recommendations, three main recommendations, and one of them was to create a streetscape plan. And so that's how we got here tonight. And I'd like to highlight some of the task force's goals for the downtown and with this plan, because I think you'll be seeing them reflected in the draft plan that you see. So one of the goals was to address underutilized areas by in favor of creating more plazas, more public spaces to gather. Another goal of theirs was to create a more cohesive design to facilitate better connections amongst the amenities downtown. And then the third was to reimagine downtown as no longer a place that people just want to get through, but rather, a place that people want to stay, linger, and enjoy. So again, our hope is that you see those goals reflected in the Streetscape Plan tonight. And I also want to note a couple of changes. So we have made an update to the presentation that you see in your packet. And I apologize for that, but it's because we wanted to share some of the results of the open house with you that we just did on Saturday. So we will be providing, we'll be making the latest presentation available for the public following the presentation. And then final note is we wanted, yes, you are seeing, what you're seeing is the draft plan as was presented to the public on Saturday, which means that we haven't had the ability to make changes based on the feedback that we got. So this isn't the finalized plan that you're seeing. We still are making changes to it, and we still want to make changes to it, which is a perfect time to get any of your questions and feedback. So with that said, I'd like to introduce Leslie and Ida, who are on our project team. They are consultants for us, and they'll be going through some of the plans. Oops, go past that.
Hi, my name is Ida Ades, and I'm with Nakano Associates. I'm first going to give you an overview of the public outreach that we've been doing as part of this project. So we started off in October of last year with meeting with walking through the downtown with the Old Town Vitality Task Force and the DIA. And really that gave us a good understanding and start of understanding the needs of some of the residents, organizations, and businesses downtown. We followed up with an online survey that got a really good response. We had 325 responses to that survey, where we were really asking some basic questions about what people like to do downtown, how they get there, kind of just getting a basic understanding of what people want to see downtown. Following that, actually, during the same time as the online survey, we also had a meeting at City Hall where we kind of outlined some initial thoughts on where the streetscape plan could go. And from that meeting, we got some really positive reactions to the idea of adding, making maybe all the street into a festival street, improving the pedestrian lighting, and also adding a crosswalk at Village Theatre and Shell Station. We also heard that generally the number one priority should be street trees and wider sidewalks. In February, we had a meeting at the community center, which was very successful. I think we really captured a broad audience with several families coming. And we presented two different streetscape concepts that showed various degrees of planting street trees and other pedestrian improvements. And from that meeting, we got really good response to some screening of parking. You'll be seeing all these concepts later on in this presentation. The Village Theatre crosswalk, we got a good feedback on, as well as the Festival Street. And we also got a good response to using flowering trees and more plantings. Our last event was just this past Saturday. And at the same time, we've also had an online survey that went out on Thursday. At the meeting on Saturday, we had 40 plus people stop by and fill out a questionnaire, also providing comments on the plans as they are, as you see them today. And we've had 160 respondents on the online survey since Thursday, which is really good. And we kind of start browsing through this information. We can see that there's some really strong opinions and setting some direction for where we want to go next. So I'm going to walk you through the boards. So we're going to start at the south end of our kind of scope of looking at Front Street, which is starting at Bush Street. So this board shows the section of Front Street between Bush Street and Sunset Way. And this is part of downtown, although you don't have the business presence as you have further north. So our approach here was really to think about how do we make this a better pedestrian and a safer pedestrian connection. And we were proposing to remove one lane of parking. This is the one area where we're actually showing a lot of parking removed. Everywhere else, it's just a parking spot here and there. But here we showed removing parking in favor of adding a buffer between the sidewalk and the street. And we got overwhelmingly heard that people don't want us to remove parking. So we'll have to kind of revisit this one based on your input too, of course. And we kind of approached it that way, looking at the parking. We figured maybe this is a place where we can remove some of the parking. But I think we'll maybe have a chance to discuss that further on. This board shows the section of Front Street between Sunset Way and Alder, and this is the section of Front Street that was completed in the fall. So we have the sidewalk, widened sidewalks, we have the infrastructure to create this next phase, which would be adding the street trees back in, adding site furnishings and plantings in accordance with this plan. So this would kind of complete this portion of Front Street.
Further, yeah. I'll be jumping in here and there to introduce some topics for you to discuss, because we don't want to be talking at you the whole evening. So a couple of the things that Ida mentioned in this section is the proposed all-way cross. So if you're familiar with how these things work, so that's at the front and Sunset intersection. So that would mean that the pedestrians, what we've heard from pedestrians is that it's very time-consuming to cross the street, especially if you're trying to go from, say, a pedestrian park to maybe the Issaquah Brew House, or maybe from Front Street Market to the library. And so the idea of the all-way crosswalk came up because this way pedestrians are able to cross the street in any direction that they like, including diagonally. And so there's examples of these types of crosswalks in other places that maybe you've seen. And so we put that in there as a concept for consideration. I think any of these concepts that you see, some of them might warrant further study. So we've gotten some really positive feedback on this. Pedestrians are really excited about this idea, and they think that this is a good intersection to try this idea. But there's also been some concerns. What's the effect going to be to traffic? Is this going to increase wait times at the lights? And so what we'd like to find out is if you have any initial thoughts or feedback on this question of having an all-way crosswalk there. And then also, I think what we would like to recommend from the administration standpoint is saying that we'd like to keep this concept in there, but then we haven't done any study for how it's going to impact traffic as a grid in Issaquah and impact pedestrian wait times as well. So we know it's a concept that has worked in other places. We still need to figure out if it's going to really work in Issaquah with the conditions that we have here.
Yeah. So Andrea, are you going to ask for feedback as we go or at the end?
Yes, feedback as we go would be great.
Comment question. Comment is okay. Generally like these, I've seen them, you see them quite a bit out east, I think, like Boston area, and I think they work really well. The question I would have would be, we have a challenge often at rush hour, cars fail to clear the intersection when the light changes, and so I'd want to make sure as we go forward that we understand how we handle those sorts of situations. There's oftentimes like southbound traffic on Front Street won't clear Sunset before the light changes, and so Sunset cars are trying to scoot around people, or people are trying to continue to get out of the intersection, and just understanding that that's sort of a unique situation. And then the other question I had was that you mentioned that work had started already on Front Street north of Sunset, and I'm just, and of course, which I mean, that's not a surprise to me, but the question is, and we knew that was the case, but how was that started when we didn't have this whole plan in place yet?
Yeah, so the work that I think you're referring to is the drainage system replacement that was done in front of Jack's. And we also did a number of crosswalk improvements for pedestrians and to keep compliance with the ADA requirements. So that work was done this summer. We widened the sidewalks there knowing that the Old Town Vitality Task Force had suggested, boy, wider sidewalks would really do an immense amount of good here. And so we tried to take as many of the recommendations from the Old Town Vitality Task Force as we could, while also leaving it somewhat of a blank slate, knowing that the streetscape planning process was still coming. And so that's why we haven't done things like replace the trees that were taken out, because we first wanted to be thoughtful and ask the question, well, what kinds of trees, and what do we want that to look like? So I think for the project that we're talking about, that generally is in front of Jack's on Front Street, south of Sunset, we wanted to balance both the desire to, if we have to tear up the sidewalk to fix this drainage project, we want to build in as many of these amenities that we think are coming, that the public has told us that they want, but not get too far ahead of ourselves before we've been able to be fully thoughtful about it.
I think there's some confusion in the community because I got cornered at church on Sunday and got about a 10-minute lecture about how somebody felt, and I think they thought that that was permanent, what was being done there. So the more we can communicate that that's a work in progress, the better.
Yes.
Andrew, you had mentioned that there are some of these around. There's one down by UW.
It is really easy for people to go down and try it out, and it is kind of odd when you're not used to it. So are there other examples that are close to Issaquah that people could actually?
Pike Place Market has
same
one.
Thing.
The entry to Pike Place Market is one. Oh, yeah. West Seattle has one at California and Alaska.
The Bellevue Transit Center, downtown Bellevue.
That's one. Okay.
And I guess my feedback on it is that I think it's fantastic. I think this is an area of town that we're trying to get people to, not necessarily people in their cars to, but people. And so this all-way stop and the presentation of how it would look is fantastic. And thanks for clarifying that we have to do a study, because this has also got some engineering components to it. So I'm really like what I see.
Great.
And I also think it's fantastic. I've experienced using those as well, and they've been great. And so I would be in favor of keeping it in the plan and taking the next step.
Great.
And my thought on these, I think they work great, particularly when there are a lot of pedestrians. They tend to lose their efficiency when there's only a light pedestrian traffic. So that'd be interesting, like, you know, later on at night, one person wants to cross and everybody has to stop in all directions for one person to cross. It kind of gets a little weird. So I don't know how that will work, but with in busy times, it's definitely, I've seen it work really well, but I'm concerned about, other than that, if there's ways to be able to cross one street and not shut everything down when that's flowing. But that's just a thought on that.
Okay. All right.
So overall, I think that I really like what I see. I think that would be a great idea, but the study, I think, would be important just so we could understand some of the issues that we're talking about here.
Okay, great. Thank you. Another thing, let me see if it's highlighted here. So I'm gonna back up here. I think you can see the areas that are dotted in kind of blue are optional or suggested areas for bioretention or rain gardens. So this is something else that we received some, there's mixed feelings about. There's some trade-offs that come with bioretention and rain gardens. First is that with the new stormwater requirements, we are obligated to look at different ways of dealing with stormwater than maybe some other traditional methods. And so there's benefits in terms of environmental stewardship. In terms of implementation costs, it's actually a lot cheaper than other forms of stormwater management. And there's the added bonus of being able to break up some of the hardscape, add more greenery to downtown, and another buffer from traffic for the pedestrians. And so while there's all these advantages to it, there's also been some expressed concerns. Bioretention and rain gardens in a dense downtown area, what does that look like? Are they just gonna be magnets for cigarette butts and trash? And then if they don't function that well, they can also, I've been informed, they can also produce a bad smell. Mm-hmm. So these are concerns that I think we've heard. There's a lot of positives and there's a lot of negatives to these things. So I think how it's seen in the plan is that these are options that I think we would like to take a look at in a more holistic way with a downtown stormwater management plan, because I think stormwater is going to be increasingly difficult in the downtown as we move forward. But so we'd like to keep them as options for consideration as part of more of a holistic view of stormwater throughout the downtown.
Yeah, just in regards to that, we just spent a lot of money to take care of stormwater, and I assume we met all the requirements, and it's a pure functioning system now. So it seems like a little after the fact to say, look at that now when we should have met all the requirements.
So this is just one of the areas that it suggested, and I'm bringing it up now because it's the first time it comes up in the slides. There's other areas downtown that are potential areas too.
Just follow up on Bill's question. So would the purpose be as a demonstration of how you might alternatively handle stormwater, or is it a capacity issue that if we increase the hardscape, we have to increase the storm capacity?
I'm going to defer to our consultants on the technical questions.
I think it would be more of a demonstration, really, because we are not increasing impervious areas as part of this project. All the water that falls on sidewalks is considered clean, and that's water we don't have to filter. So this, what we're showing here are locations where we could take some of the road runoff, road stormwater, and clean it in these planters.
And why just the two planters shown there in this area? Is there, I was just looking maybe at the corner or at the pedestrian park. Are there options, or that if we're going to do it as an option, that's the only place we can do it?
We were really looking, actually working with Public Works. We were looking at locations where we were not right next to, say, outdoor seating areas.
Okay.
So really looking at more places and locations where people sort of move along the sidewalk to not have the issues with some of the issues that Andrea talked about.
Thanks.
Any other questions or comments?
I guess my only comment would be if we're afraid to talk about kind of what the negative impact could be, that would be a concern for me,
yeah,
since we're wanting it to be so pedestrian heavy.
I'd like to add, right, too, that a lot of the considerations is, I mean, typically these can be designed so that they're not failing and you don't have the smells. I think the other consideration is, yes, this does require more maintenance than, say, a dry well or a filter cartridge, but that's sort of where you have to weigh the benefits with maybe having a demonstration project, showing kind of a city policy as opposed to the budget that it would take to maintain them, which is higher than some other
right,
solutions. Yeah.
Right.
Yep. Thanks.
Okay.
Oh, Tala has a comment. Yeah.
If it's gone round once already. The eight foot tall decorative screen that's on the west side of front between the library and Ed Jones is looking up street. Oh, I see. Okay. So is traffic one way on that entrance, or can traffic come out that?
Traffic is one way, and it's coming out onto Front Street. That's
out.
Actually, in this particular location, it goes in.
Oh, it does. Okay.
So you won't have people coming out, because I was concerned because it was looking up traffic, right? It would potentially impede the view of traffic, because the one on the other side is looking downstream, if you will. But if nobody can, if the intention is not to have people come out from there, then it's not.
Right, right. And the other idea is that we want, while the screens are there to help break up some of these spaces between asphalt and the pedestrian area, we also think it's important for them to be somewhat see-through, both for security purposes and pedestrian safety.
The screens can provide a little pocket of seating or planting along as you move down Front Street. They're also a great opportunity to provide some custom artwork. So we could work with local artists to design these screens and give a little bit more of that character to Front Street that I think people would like to see. This second slide shows improvements from Alder Street to Dogwood, and we kind of jumped over Alder. Leslie's going to talk more about Alder Street and the idea of a festival street. So we'll kind of move on northward on Front Street. This shows a continuation of the improvements that were done south of Alder, with the difference here that the sidewalks would be widened and replaced. And to be clear, we're not narrowing the street other than that we're grabbing a foot or two from the parking lanes, and we're making the parking lanes narrower, still meeting city standards for parking widths for parking stalls. So the drive lanes remain at their current width. On this slide, you see the suggestion of adding a crosswalk between Village Theater and Shell Station. We got really positive feedback on this. I think a majority of the comments were really in favor of this addition. And in addition to that, you also see a streetscape that's enhanced with a few more street trees than what's out there currently. And also in discussions with the Parks Department, they were really in favor of plantings in planters. And so we're showing these little round dots here are plantings with small trees in them, and they also provide seating. And I'll show you some images of that later. Here's another version of a decorative screen at the bike shop, and we'll come back to this, but this would be a kind of a public-private partnership to get these in place, because these are located a foot or two in on private properties. The parking areas are private. And this shows kind of an enhanced crosswalk and additional plantings and street trees at the Music and Arts. This shows the new crosswalk between the Village Theater and the Shell Station. This improvement would require the removal of one parking stall in front of Shell Station. This plan is at a larger scale. It shows improvements from Dogwood to Gilman Boulevard. And starting at the north, this corner needs some love. This would be a great location for a new welcome sign. This is really the start of a kind of old, or not technically, but this is really the start of Front Street, per se. And also using the art wrapping for those utility cabinets that are there. There are a few. We talked to Public Works today about providing landscape screening, but just the way they're located, that might not always be possible. So maybe using that the program of wrapping them in art would work really well here. And then really creating a gateway here. As you move further south on Front Street, we are here showing a proposed enhanced pedestrian walkway along the east side. Looking at the west side with Derigold, we felt like there was really important to maintain their access and at least on one side provide a more safe pedestrian access to further south in downtown. We are here also introducing the idea of a parklet. This one would be located outside the Mercantile Building. We also are proposing that there could be one outside the brewery, but that is really where that is also a private public partnership, and we've gotten mixed feedback on the parklets. So
that's another thing that we wanted to talk to you about tonight. I think the original mission for the Old Time Vitality Task Force was to identify these things that the community can do together. And so there's a number of partnership opportunities that are coming through with the proposed streetscape plan. And one of them is this idea of a parklet, or converting, in this case we're talking about converting a parking space in front of the Mercantile Building to a kind of like a park or public place. So where folks who are maybe going to the bakery can grab a cup of coffee and a pastry and have a place to sit and eat it outside. So that's something that was proposed. We had some mixed feedback. Some people really loved the idea. Some people thought, boy, I can't believe you're proposing to take away a parking spot. But there's a couple of advantages. You know, we've heard from the task force and a number of other members of the public that they want more outdoor seating. They want more of these places where they can hang out with friends and family. And then it also, by removing the parking space and putting a seating area there instead, it increases visibility for some of the small businesses in the Mercantile Building so that folks can see what's there better and would help support small businesses. So there's a couple of goals there. And I guess while we're looking at some of these opportunities for public partnerships, knowing that we have received this mixed feedback from the public, I'm curious to hear your thoughts and feedback and whether you would like us to pursue this type of partnership with a private business.
Maybe I can quickly go to that slide.
Yeah, is there another visual?
Well, here's a visual.
Here's a visual of the one that's proposed outside of the Issaquah Brew House.
And I quickly like to mention too that this is something that really could be installed on a very seasonal basis. Like for example, outside the brewery, you could try it out for a summer. And it's not something permanent. It's actually designed such that you can take it down and store it if you have to.
Well, I love the creativity of it. And as far as taking parking away, it seems like the one who's harmed the most is the business that would be using the parklet. I just love coming up with creative ideas, so I like it. Ella?
So I'll be the Grinch here. I'm not crazy about it. I think that the public continues to show a lot of sensitivity, unfortunately, to losing any parking whatsoever, as you've alluded to, and I think we're all extremely aware of. So, and I think it, making it temporary, unfortunately, makes it even more, I think, problematic from my perspective. I do like the idea, however, of you showed a park area near one of these on front that I think would be a private partnership that is set back from the road, right? That is between two buildings? When you showed on another
with
view.
A decorative screen?
No. If you go back to the view of Front Street North, and it was a top-down view. Keep going. It was a top-down view. It was a planned view of the street.
Oh, the planned view.
Yeah. Keep going. Sorry. It's there. Yeah. Okay. So where you've got art installation planned at unused roadway at Issaquah Creek Bridge. Mm-hmm. There. Okay. So if you had park on the north side and park on the south side, and you were doing some sort of mini park that sort of like is going in over by Atlas, which people are excited about initially, I think having something like that in front of a green area would have a different feel than putting something like that in a parking spot in front of a business. Again, I'm just one of seven, but that feels different to me than like what you show in front of the brew house.
Yeah, and that provides another opportunity for a partnership. So the creek overlook is something that's recommended there, but that would only be accessible from the Dairy Gold parking lot. And that would be another partnership that, given the adoption of the plan and your permission to proceed, we'd like to pursue with Dairy Gold to see if they were willing for us to partner on how to reuse some of that space and provide more of these connections to the creek and really capitalize on that amenity.
And then the second point I had was that you mentioned potentially narrowing the parking spots. So can somebody, it's been a while since I've been on Land and Shore, sadly, and so I don't remember widths on parking spots, but having just gotten somewhat beaten up about the parking that's up by pad one, what's the general standard for parking spot width? What is it in the Highlands? What is it in the area that the citizens have just been complaining about? So how would the new parking compare to what we just got yelled at over?
Good question. So this would be, what we're trying to do with the street is create a good balance between the amount of roadway that we have for the travel lanes and the parking lanes. And I think one of the criticisms I've heard and complaints I've heard about what's happened in the Highlands is that they went for maybe more of the narrow roadway and for a travel lane and a narrow parking lane. So I think what we're trying to do maybe be a little more generous. Of course, Keith would be able to speak to more specifics than I would.
So I can't tell you what they are on Sunset. Maybe one of our consultants could address that. But in the Highlands, so phase one of parking, we started at 6 foot wide parking lanes. And then, so that would be most of kind of everything east of 15th up through the residential area. They were at 6 feet. We realized that was too narrow. So the parking bays along the couplet, Highlands Drive and 9th, are at 8 feet. And we found that those were more than adequate to allow for the car to actually be off from the curb and not be sticking into the travel lane.
That's very helpful. Now, how does that compare to what we're talking about here?
These are 9 feet.
These are 9 feet. All right, you've answered my question. Thank you very much.
So I'm also very much in favor of these parklets. I've seen them used in other towns. I think one of the really difficult things for us to see forward to now is that we do have, we accommodate a very large stream of traffic through town. And this plan, which I like, may be a way of us to recharacter this piece of town and not make all of our decisions in how to get more cars through faster, but how to make this a place to be where cars might go very slow enough to the point where they don't want to use it as a pass through. So a parklet to me is an awesome idea. And the only sensitivity I have to it is that I think if the council goes with the plan and if there's a funding mechanism and a phasing for the plan, that we have to do it through a parking filter, meaning that if we are going to remove, we need to add. And so we should take the fear of losing parking off and say the council may want to commit to we will find before we take away, so that we're net neutral in the end. But there are a lot of mountain towns who use these mechanisms to create the street activity. They do it on a temporary basis or a permanent basis. It totally changes the character of the street. So I'm totally in support of it. I think it looks great.
So I want clarification on the parking size lane. So it's currently 9 feet, and it would go to 8 feet, is what you were saying, I think?
No, let me see here.
What's it currently and what it would go to?
I wonder if I can...
Actual measurement there.
Yes, do you have that? Thank you. I'll just quickly... I just want to make sure I actually give you the right dimensions, but I'm pretty sure that they're actually 11 feet currently. So looking at an existing versus proposed... Can you help me out here? What does that say here?
So let's see. Not for parking.
That is small. It looks like 9 feet to me.
So you drive from 11 feet to 9 feet?
Yes. With,
and that'd be on both sides of the road?
Yes.
All right, just want to clarify that. And while we're on parking, my 2 cents on parking is considered, and I know you're sensitive to it, I just want to look at it this way. You said there's 20, proposed 23 spots being lost with this as it is. I know they're spread out, but total of 23. And, you
actually,
know,
I think there are a few more. There's probably a total of 25.
Yeah, 25, close enough. And people have talked about a parking structure here in somewhere in Old Town. And parking structure spots are $20,000 to $30,000 a piece. So if you multiply that out, you're talking about $600,000 to replace the parking we already have. So I just want to put a price tag on to notice that that's all of a sudden doing this. I mean, just to keep what we currently have would be about $600,000 to replace it. That's a possibility.
That's one option.
One option, yeah.
You could also work with private property owners who currently have private spots that are not used at night,
right,
and try and get an inventory.
My next point.
Okay.
I was talking. That looking at private lots that currently may have been, you know, busy during the day, but not at night, and we could, you know, where they would agree to public parking at times that they're not needing that, they're parking for their business. Those kind of joint partnerships I was also looking for. And one other question on the parklet. So, like, on a piece of the street where it looks like it might be just a bench or something to sit down in open space, but when you put the piece in front of the brewery and the umbrellas, it looks to me like an extension of the restaurant, and now it looks like a part of the business. And now we've just created public space and expanded someone's business space. Mm-hmm. So that's a different thing than creating really public space, because now it's actually part of the restaurant. So I'm not sure how you're looking at those, and I know they could be not obvious, but I just look at that, because if we're just expanding someone's business at a public expense, I would have some concern at that without some sort of partnership with the restaurant and seeing who's covering those expenses.
Yes, I think that's where the partnership comes into play.
Right.
So I don't think we would, in other places where this is done, the arrangement typically is that the business, if it benefits that business, then the business would then pay for construction and maintenance of that, and the city would grant use of the right-of-way. So
right.
I think we would pursue a similar arrangement with businesses like the brewery if we were to move forward.
And then I've got a bunch here because I've been waiting. And one last one is, other concern is sidewalks overall. And this is a discussion that started back in infrastructure committee. But right now our code says that the private property owner is responsible for sidewalk installation and maintenance and so forth at their expense. And so I know Dia and those folks have been involved. I'm just wondering how much they're involved in the fact of talking about partnerships. If we're improving, we're looking at doing sidewalk repair, replacement, maintenance in front of a private property at city expense, where other people in town are required to do it at their own expense. I want to see how that's balanced, because I don't think we should have a difference of, you know, if I'm required to pay for my sidewalk maintenance, but someone else doesn't have to, the city pays for that. We have an equity problem, and who's paying for what? And I can't use taxpayers' dollars to pay for something that private property has to pay for. So I think that's a major question in here on how this whole thing is funded. And I'm hoping Dee and all those folks have been brought in and somehow looking at that, because the benefits of this are going to be to the businesses there, hopefully, in the long run, and how much they're willing to put in to be a part of that.
Yeah, we look forward to having those discussions with you next month. when we talk about funding mechanisms and potential funding mechanisms.
I want to throw it out now.
Great. Thank you. Thank you.
Ryan?
Ryan.
Sorry, did you have?
No? Good.
So just in regard to the parklet, I just wanted to say I really like the way that looks, and I do think that that's creative and something that really adds to the downtown and really focuses things on pedestrian and walking around. And so I'm excited about that. But I would echo what Mary Lou talked about in terms of parking and coming up with a plan and letting us, you know, talk about that as well. So if there's a way to have that become net neutral. And I know that we've talked a little bit about, you know, some of those parking spots that are reserved throughout the day and the evening that say that you can't park there. And, you know, some different ideas that we could brainstorm about trying to make that net neutral.
Could we get something included in the streetscape plan budget to replace these tables? All right.
Good. Okay. Thank you.
Stacy.
Oh, you got.
Sorry,
call?
Really quick. So I'm in generally in favor of the idea. I like the creativity. I like the idea to explore that and get us to all think about something different than we have now. It does seem very consistent with the goals for the project and what we're trying to achieve. There's no doubt about that at all. I would express some caution about the parklets, I guess my biggest concern is one of aesthetics. They can, if you know, generally temporary is a concern of mine. I don't know if anybody else has expressed that, you know, something that's temporary looks temporary, and it then actually takes away from the actual visual appeal and the aesthetics that we're trying to create. So that was one thought. And the other one, too, is, you know, I do know, especially you mentioned the brewery, and in fact that they do use a very narrow sidewalk for outdoor dining today. And I would expect that if indeed, like Bill said, if there's a net increase in their capacity to serve business, that would be one thing. If it just opens up the sidewalk so that it's easier for pedestrians, I think that's a different consideration. In other words, there would be no net gain in seating capacity or business capacity.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Great. Let's see. Okay, so we want to talk about two sort of special spots. So we've been looking at Front Street and focusing on that, but also mindful of Old Town is wider than Front Street, and finding ways that we can kind of weave people east and west as well. So certainly one of the things that we want to weave into the mix more strongly is the fish hatchery. So as everyone was just saying, there's the parklet for the brewery, if it happens. It's very, very narrow in terms of the sidewalk there, and there's big poles in the middle of it. So it feels kind of inadequate. One of the great things that we've found working with the fish people is that they have extra space in that asphalt. So we can push a little bit back into that zone so that we can widen the sidewalk and have a zone of landscape and seating and some educational stuff about what's actually going on at the fish hatchery. We could also get there's just, you can see the kind of places where people can sit, the wider sidewalk. And if you're looking at the storm drainage and where you can have the most fish-friendly landscape storm drainage, this might be one of those candidates for it. We've looked at this one. So this is an image of what it might look like. So you can just see, instead of that being the sidewalk now, that we'd bring it over so there's more room to maneuver and places where people could sit, and a more obvious but small entry at this zone. It's not the main entry, but it just kind of helps people understand where they can go and where they shouldn't go. So it's fenced off with a nicer fence than is there now, one that relates to the ones that we're having at the parking area. And again, you can kind of see through it, but it's lovely and relates to the place and could be specific to the art of the fish. So that's one of the things that we're looking at. And I think it really does tie in well to the idea of this being a full-way cross. You know, this must have been an old railroad route into here, but that kind of helps you get to a pedestrian park and into where the trains are now. The other thing to point out, we can talk about that later, that we haven't really redone the parking back there, but the hope is that that would be cleaned up and a little bit more thoughtful with the dumpsters so that there could be a pedestrian route along here and the parking was a little less chaotic. So that's a bit of an exercise in itself, but it's part of the whole idea of making this connection more apparent and more pleasant. So this is a fun one. A festival street is a place that's designed to accommodate festivals, even though most of the time it's working for cars and for people. So Alder is a really interesting street because it's not very long. So there's not a lot of traffic. The traffic's there. It can't get up ahead of steam. So it's slow and infrequent traffic. So it's a really good candidate for this. And what we'd like to do, this is sort of small, but is to add the landscape. There it is. Yeah. We want to add landscape to it. We want to add seating and the tree canopy and the idea of lights that have the catenary twinkle lights there that kind of fit into the theme that you already have going at the building tops. So this would be usable by cars and pedestrians for almost all the time, but it still has a character so that you know even when it's a rainy Tuesday that you can kind of imagine that salmon walk is going to happen when the sun comes out, or they're talking about wine walks and some other things. So these are pretty successful if you've got something as active as your DIA that can make really good use of it. And it'll bring people back to the parking and the train, and it'll get people over to First Street. So it does a lot of really good things at once, and we've gotten a lot of good feedback about this. Saturday morning out in the rain, we went and took some spray chalk and showed where the landscape would be in the poles, and I checked on the way in. You can still see the remnant of the chalk. So if you have an umbrella, go stand there, and you can kind of feel where those poles would be and where the plantings would be. Yeah, so do you want to talk about those two things?
So any feedback that you have or questions on any of those concepts about the fish hatchery entrance, the festival street?
Raya?
Other than I really like what I see.
Yeah.
I like the visual of both of those. I think that would be a great improvement.
Great, thank you.
I would just add to that that the ability to get some of that off Front Street directly, mm-hmm. and it would feel like an expansion, and it would make everything feel bigger, like putting a mirror in a room kind of thing. I think it would do a lot. And there you have with the hatchery working with us to get some of that space, which you can't get other places, would be wonderful. So I think that's some good opportunities.
Great.
Generally, I like this a lot. Almost all of it. I do wonder sometimes, or I there's a thought in the back of my head that keeps coming back, but I'm concerned about that the elephant in the room is that we don't have structured parking downtown. And all the other compact downtowns on the east side have structured parking. And what down the road, I think there will come a day, maybe I won't still be on the council, but there'll come a point when we will decide that we need to do it for businesses and for what it would allow us to do beyond this. And my only thought, and I realize we don't have any way to do it today, but you know, what structured parking would mean and the fact that you could re-baseline this whole thing and do an order of magnitude more creative and interesting things. And Bill's right, it's $20,000 a stall for structured parking. It's six for street for surface parking, but it's 20 for structured. But that's the only question, and it's not a decision we can make today. And this is a great use of you know the levers that you have in front of you. But I just wonder when we as a council get to the point where we'll take on that structured parking issue, and then that would allow us to do stuff mm-hmm. like this, only even more. And what that private partnership, private public partnership, would look like, because we
have done businesses. If the public knew that, you know, there wasn't going to be a problem finding parking on a Friday night in downtown, what that would mean for our businesses would be really interesting.
So as I recall, I thought there was some direction given and that the council gave to the administration toward the 2 years. Well, there was a most recent one. I think it was having to do with what we were not going to include in the bond, but yet we still had some important issues.
The response is coming.
So can you fill us in on where we are with that? We asked for some information back on what we might be able to do for parking.
Sure, I don't have the exact motion in front of me right now, but
sure, I appreciate that.
Paraphrase,
yeah.
Was to come back with a plan to study options and subsequently hopefully make some recommendations on how to address parking needs in our Old Town area. And council gave us two years to kind of come back with that work. So as a status update, we're probably, I think that happened in the summertime, and here we are just short of maybe
spring.
Half a year, three quarters of a year, and that work is not yet underway, was not on our work plan for this year, so I would anticipate it would be a 2018 work item.
That was a really good comment, Tola, about if we could deal with the parking, we could be an amped up version of what we're looking at. So I guess we're going to get to parking, maybe in 2018 or end of 2018, but I do like this Festival Street concept.
Mm-hmm.
And also maybe the private-public partnership, if the downtown revitalization does start to happen and property owners want to work with us, even creating between two buildings a covered area, if we have coordinated building applications. Would be great. The concept sketches are awesome.
Great.
And at the hatchery.
Great, thank you.
One quick comment. So I was recently in I think it was down in San Jose, and there is a Festival Street area there. And what was notable was that they also had an art overarching sign. You knew that you were entering mm-hmm. into a special area. And I'm not a designer, I'm glad you are, but that was my one reaction when I saw this. I like the concept and another element to, like I just found very appealing.
That's a great idea.
So are you done with your presentation?
Yes.
Okay, so a couple things, next steps, and then can you talk about the ongoing opportunities for public comment?
Yes, thank you. So next steps is that first, I'm handing this project over to Kristen Leeson, who is here tonight. As I think most of you know, my last day with the City of Issaquah is this week, and I'm moving on to other opportunities. So Kristen will be managing the project after I leave, and then she'll be coming back to council in April. So we are looking for your recommendations as to which council committee you would prefer to have this discussion, and the topics, especially in April, you'll get to see the revised plans with the updates from public comment and from your feedback tonight, and then having a discussion about the costs for these projects and what some potential funding mechanisms are and what the trade-offs are of those funding mechanisms. So that's the next step in our conversation that we will have in April. And then we'll also be asking for adoption of the plan as a supplement to the Old Town plan. So that's also something that we look forward to in the next month or so. Options for public feedback. We do have an online survey that is still active throughout the rest of the week. So for folks who haven't had the opportunity to fill that out, it can be found on our website, issaquahwa.gov/oldtown. And that's old with an E, O-L-D-E, town without an E. So recommendations for the next step for which committee you'd prefer this to go to?
We have three. I think you all could make a case for going to any of the three committees.
Yeah, I think it should go to services, because even though this is not your typical definition of a park, we're creating a community space, and I really think it should have a touch through parks and through services. And I'm not on services.
Okay. Anybody else want to make a comment as an interested member of your own committee?
And I'm looking at infrastructure as well. So it is part of our infrastructure, but I don't, you know, I wouldn't, I don't know this, we need someone, but that's, I think, often where it would go as well, because we're changing it.
Aren't you on that committee as well?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
But I'm fine with total handling if he wants to, too. But that's the two I think it does most.
So you're on both those committees, right?
No longer. No, I'm not on his anymore.
Oh, okay. I was just kind of joking. Sounds like services.
Great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep. Paul?
Yeah, go ahead. So I've been keeping a focus on the goals for this project as we've gone through some of this. I just wanted to constantly tie it back. And I think the overall concept and a lot of the elements that are here do a fantastic job at delivering on the goal. So I commend you. I do also appreciate quite a bit of the amount of engagement you've had and will continue to have. You know the importance of that, and that means a lot to me too. When you come back, the power of it, when you come back here and say, you know, we've had these points and we've had as many people involved, that's so powerful. So we need that. We need to hear that when that happens, so I appreciate it. And the last thing I'll say is that, you know, actually, Andrea, it was totally news to me. Okay. And if this is the final project that you shepherd through to the City Council, then my gosh, you're leaving on a really good note. Thank you.
Thank you.
And one last comment. I know I crossed the line already talking about funding, and so I'll cross it one more time. I know we're talking about tonight, but in the plan, I think one of the nice things was on some of the options you had, like some dollar signs, like $2 signs or $3 signs, which said, you know, obviously one's more expensive than another. When we do get to funding, if we can actually put some approximate real dollars in there than that might give us a good thing, because if it's $50 more, it's one thing. I know when I go to get a hotel and it says it rises $1 sign, it might go from 200 to 500 a night, and that's a lot, or it might go $50 a night. So just I think that will give folks a more concrete thing when you get to that.
Great.
Thank you.
Mariah?
So just one quick comment and question about the Gilman, that little area at the end of Gilman and Front. It talks about enhanced signage. Could you explain a little bit more about what might be the signage that might be proposed for that area? Because that is an area that it's great to see that some enhanced things are happening there, because that does need some TLC.
I think the idea is to have gateway signage there. It's something that we've talked through over the years as a community, is this idea to have a nice gateway welcome to Issaquah sign, and that seems like a good opportunity for us to place such a sign.
Okay. And I just wanted to say that I think overall this looks great, and I've gotten a chance to work with you on economic vitality and through council, and you're going to be greatly missed.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, for sure. You will be greatly missed. Best of luck to you.
Thank you.
And this is the time that, you know, a lot of the times I would call for public comment, but because we have a lot of work, but primarily because we still have the online survey that's available through the city website, and we've also had a very robust public feedback process with this, I'm not going to have any right now. But I encourage people to go take the survey on the city's website.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is affordable housing strategy.
I don't know how I follow up the Love Fest for Andrew.
For chiming in.
Jeez, thanks for that.
We love this topic too.
Yeah, you have different stuff. And these are somebody's? Okay. You're all ready? Tonight, we have 45 minutes to walk you through the update of the housing strategy with a focus on the affordability piece that we're working on for the moratorium. We're going to give you a small little background. We're going to zip through the problem statements that the Joint Committees of Economic Vitality, Planning Policy Commission, and Human Services have been meeting, and they've worked through some problem statements. We'll talk a little bit about what the focus group has found out and some of the commission findings. And then we're going to start to unpack a few of the strategies that we've come up with just on the affordability piece, and then talk about the next steps. So you've seen this graphic a few times. This is to remind you how far we've come already. This was a council goal for you all, just as the housing strategy. And after the moratorium, it turned into just affordable housing. So we're doing all of it together with the piece of affordability coming through first. In September, we gave you an update on what the existing conditions were for the housing that we have today. And if we forecasted that same housing and the percentages, what that would be in 20 years. And it turned out we were pretty lopsided. And so now we're working on what does it mean to change our focus a little bit, and how would we have to tweak what we have now and how we're moving forward to get a different sort of diversity of housing to play back to what the facts that we're finding. Are there any questions with where we are today and how far we've come? Okay, we're in the step two, we're in the needs analysis. Our Rockstar committees have met three times, commissions, and they've done a lot of really good work. We've had six focus groups of different sorts of housing to find out sort of what's really going on with the housing providers and the service providers. And we're hoping to come back to you all at the end of the needs analysis to sort of wrap up this piece. The first thing we did with the Joint Commissions was we wanted them to figure out what's the mission statement for the whole housing strategy to help us sort of litmus test everything that we do to make sure it still fits in with what kind of housing we want for the city for the future. And this is what they came up with. It took them some wordsmithing, as you all know. That's sort of one of those things you have to do. But they all three, since they all three commissions come from very different focuses, I'll say. It's really been fun watching them work together and trying to figure out the best sort of housing for the future. The focus groups, this is sort of a summary slide of, yes.
Go back one slide, please. So the Joint Commission's draft mission statement. So tell me, in the context of what we're doing, where this lands, where does this have a find a home, and is this something
right.
that needs to be
this
adopted?
This is to help focus the three commissions and help us to figure out what do we want when we have a housing strategy in front of us. How will we know that it's what we started out? Sort of what Paul talked about in your goal. How do you check back and know that you did what you said you were going to do, or what you said you wanted us to do? And so they didn't want to regulate it as much as encourage housing that embraces our character and environment, and it provides a diversity of choices that was important to them, and that meets the needs of all the folks who live here, work here, and play. So it was sort of that global statement to help us focus the housing strategy.
So the word encourage, I guess, I'm glad Stacey asked your question. I didn't think about it that much. When we're looking at the strategies, are they all sort of encouragement and voluntary strategies,
you're
or do we have some
ahead
that would
of
be
your, You're getting ahead. This was, it's a mixture of both, and we're just starting to talk about the strategies that you guys will help unpack a few of them tonight. But this was knowing that we can't regulate all of it, that there's pieces and parts that we have to have a wide net so that we're able to get all the different kinds of housing and all the different price ranges and sizes and diversity that we need. We knew it couldn't all be regulatory. But yeah, I like that you're getting ahead though. I'm not being mad. I'm glad that it's exciting. And I'm going to have John come up. He's one of our Rockstar Planning Policy Commission members, and he's going to talk a little bit about the three meetings. He was at all three the big joint committee meetings, and just a little bit of what they came up with. Thanks, John.
Of course. Yeah, so as Trish mentioned, it was a lot of great perspectives from the whole group. We hadn't gathered all together before, so that was really good to get together and roll our sleeves up and talk through some of this stuff.
John, can you introduce yourself?
I'm sorry. I'm John Staub. I'm on the Planning Policy Commission.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay.
So as we started our discussion, we talked a lot about what do we value about Issaquah. And we talked about how lovely it is. It's natural. We love our surrounding environment. It's safe. But the thing we kept saying is the word character. And it's something that's kind of, I guess, hard to put a finger on exactly, but that's something we definitely wanted to hold on to, because everyone certainly recognizes that Issaquah has a character that we want to preserve. We did identify a number of trends that we think that we're seeing. There seem to be a limited range of new product types coming to market that don't necessarily meet the needs of what we see as the future population here. There's less and less easy land to develop, meaning that more and more of it is close to critical areas that developers have stayed away from, and the city needs to preserve also. The workforce of our town comes from out of town a lot. And as much as there is traffic congestion that's not due to that issue at all, anything that we can do to help provide housing locally for the people that work here on a daily basis will certainly help the in and out traffic every night. So that's something that we identified. The other thing that we kind of think is that we're growing probably faster than our infrastructure can handle at this rate, especially with some of the numbers we were talking about accommodating in the future. With that, we identified a number of needs, or so we think, so we came up with. Smaller units being one that allows more flexibility and allows that workforce housing to get into this community and live here comfortably. Providing housing for all stages of life, whether it's singles, buying a house for the first time, or families that want to live here for a long time and raise kids here, or seniors that want to age in place. So we certainly recognize that as a need that we want to accommodate. There's also special populations. I mentioned seniors. Another one that kept coming up was special needs housing, and that's something that we certainly want to plan for. With all that needs to be transit accessible and walkable and still a nice place to live. So those are our challenges, and that's kind of what we came up with, and we certainly want to try to preserve Issaquah's character. So thank you.
Thank you.
We were hoping to put a video together of the focus groups and all of the commissions, but we ran out of time. Our communications group is rather stretched, as a lot of us are these days. And so someday we're hoping that we have a video that can play on the website as well to talk about all the interesting and amazing people we have in the community and how hard everybody's working on this, on housing as an issue. The next thing the Joint Commissions did was they worked on problem statements. And again, this was with all the facts that were coming at them, and you got a lot of it in your presentation that we sent you. There were so many facts that they were trying to quantify. What is this telling all of us? And so they came up with three that helped them define what it is we're really trying to fix. And so the three of them, the first one, is that John alluded to, that overall housing affordability in Issaquah and the whole region has decreased for households at all levels. And I have some data here. I put tons of data in your presentation, but lucky for you, I'm not going to go through that because I know that you read it all already. So I'm just going to say this is problem one, that housing affordability has decreased for all levels and all households. And those are the sort of the highlighted facts. The second one was that individuals and families cannot afford to choose to work and live in Issaquah. And the word choose is specifically that a lot of people would really, really like to be here, to live here where they work and where they play, but they're not able to. So the committees wanted to be sure that the word choose was in there, because certainly you can choose not to live here. Some people don't want to live here. But the majority of folks that we've been talking to in the focus groups and in the committees that talked were that they really would like to be able to choose to live here. And so that's, I just wanted to call your attention to that term there. And again, you have lots of the facts that are supporting this. I just put on a few of the highlights, that only a small share work and live here, which means that their trips are internal and that's not causing traffic, but a lot of traffic is caused by so many workers coming in and out of town. The third problem statement is the housing types aren't meeting the diversity of demand. We found in a lot of the focus group that people just want a really small one-bedroom house. And it seems most everything that's built is more than one bedroom. So just that alone is that the market is missing what a lot of the demand is. And so that's something that we wanted to work on as well. Now this is, that we're gonna start in the strategies, and I know some of you are gonna wanna jump ahead, because that's a good thing, but you can't jump too far ahead. But we, and the commissions jumped ahead too, and that was kind of exciting, but none of this is a recommendation tonight. It's just discussion only to get your feedback on what we're sort of unpacking. And this is a small part of the housing strategy. It's just the affordable part. It's not the whole strategy. I'm gonna say that again. It's not the whole strategy that we're gonna come up with. It's only the affordable part is what we're talking about tonight. The housing strategy will have everything in it, and this is just a little part. And the joint commissions are going to look at the whole big list of all of them, just so you know, they're not done yet. If any of them are watching, they're probably going, oh, we want to be done. And this is a very busy chart, but you have it in your handout as well. But what we tried to do is on the blue line are all the pieces and parts that the findings from the focus groups and the joint commissions on pieces that they thought were really important that we wanted to try to fix in the housing strategy. That's what the blue line is. And then we matched up with it. Sort of the peachy line is the data that we found in our housing inventory that we did in September. And then what we did along the side in the green, these were actions that we could take only for affordable that could help fix some or all of or most of the ones that are listed in the blue and the peach. And we're only going to talk about a few of those tonight. I think we're only going to talk about four. And the first one, these are the four. Okay, I'm getting ahead, but we're just going to unpack these a little for you tonight. The first one is accessory dwelling units, which we have now. I think we have about 40 of them now. We don't really promote them or market them or say how easy or not easy they are, but we do have them, and they're fairly successful. They're already accepted. An owner has to live in one of the units. Either you or a family member has to live in one, and then you can rent out the other to, you know, anybody want, but which is also what Mercer Island does. Mercer Island is like the poster child of a successful ADU program. And so we're talking to them about how do they do it? What's the process? You know, is it faster than ours? Is it cheaper than ours? What's Mercer Island doing that we should be doing to help with our ADUs coming online? And so we're working on that one. We figure if we're as successful as Mercer Island is with their ADUs, we could get up to about 150 more if we were as successful as in. Right now we have 40, so that would be what, tripling how many we have. So that's just a thought to think about. Are there questions on ADUs?
Just wondering if you have, you could tell us the geography of where that style of development is actually happening in town, or is that 40 spread? Like, is it in the Highlands and Talus and the Valley Floor? And
I think they're pretty much, they're allowed pretty much everywhere. So I don't actually know. I know some of them are, and I think Talus was allowed 50 of them, but they don't have that many. But I know some of them are in Old Town. I would imagine there's some in the Highlands. I don't know.
I guess my ask is, when it comes back for more discussion, mm-hmm. It'd be nice to see sort of the geography. If there's 40, where are they? Are there certain neighborhoods that this would work in better? Is there certain lot sizes that this would work in better? So just a question for mm-hmm. a future meeting.
Any other thoughts, questions, Paul?
Yeah, I believe also heard a little bit about Mercer Island's program before, but I believe if it's not already in this material, you should come forward with whether or not, under what circumstances, an ADU would drive parking, additional parking at all. And I understand that. I think by the current standards, if you have a two-car garage and a driveway, then it's counted. You get to count your two cars and in the garage and two cars in the driveway. So it's considered that you have parking for four. You add an ADU, then its allotment would come out of that four, for example. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an important point that I just would want people to understand as well.
Right. Good point. Yeah, parking in residential is always a big deal.
But overall, in general, again, I don't have a lot of experience myself, but the exposure I have had from others and hearing about it, I'm glad to see you putting an emphasis on this. I understand this that can be a very successful program, albeit a small one. And I will say, you know, in compared to the overall numbers that I think where our need is. And I'm going to take this opportunity to on your strategies and actions affordable housing slide, the previous one, mm-hmm. and you made the emphasis yourself. You said these are a small part of the housing strategy. I think it's a giant part of the housing strategy. Right. And I think the representation was earlier was done very well because there's many facets to the housing strategy, but especially if we can succeed as a community in an affordable housing strategy to create more options for housing and proximity to the jobs that people own, you know, that allow them to, you know, to live in proximity to their jobs, then that would be a tremendous gain. So it may be a small part, it's a giant part in my
right.
mind.
Right, and it's certainly going to be a hard part. I think just about every jurisdiction in the region, including Seattle, and everybody is trying to figure out how to fix the housing issue. So yeah, you're right. It's a big part, but it's a small part of the whole of all of the strategies. Hey, Tola.
How you said there's the potential for 150?
It's if you did the ratio of how Mercer Island is doing with their program, and they have a bazillion. I don't know the number exactly, but it's a lot more than we do. And then with as many housing units as we have, and we only have 40, we could actually have 150 more if we were doing, if we had the same ratio as Mercer Island.
Got it. Okay. I think about, you know, I look at the 5,000 people on Squawk Mountain, right? And I say, what if some fraction of those had ADUs, what
right.
that looked like, it'd be a lot more than 150.
Right.
I understand why you're using Mercer Island as a reference.
Just as a success, a basis of success.
Are there any legal challenges to ADUs? Like when somebody goes to sell a house, and I guess you have an ADU on it, if you want to use the ADU and you sell the property, you have to sell it to somebody who's going to live in one of those two units, right? So there's essentially a covenant on the property at that point?
I know the city rules say that one person, that your family member has to live in one of them. And so if you sold your house with an ADU to someone else and they weren't doing the same thing, I don't think there's a covenant as much as if your neighbors start complaining that there's wild parties. I mean, it might just be our teenagers are there, but that's when we would go to check out what's the problem with that house. And if we find out that, you know, that you've rented it to 17 partiers none of the families are living there, then that's when we would do some code action.
One of the partiers would have to be my son or my daughter. Got it.
Yes, yes. Which makes it fine, right? Because then it's your problem and not the city's problem. But they would never do that. I know your kids, they would never do that. Any other questions about ADUs? And at the end, we have Arthur Sullivan here who is very familiar with Mercer Island that we can ask him some questions as well on that. The next one, Transit Orient Development, that you saw a presentation from Jen here a couple of weeks ago, this also addresses all three problem statements that the committees came up with, and that's also accepted housing types that can come out of here. And we're also hoping to use the multifamily tax exemption as sort of a pilot, tested out project for this one. And that's so far the only, we're the only jurisdiction, or this is the only strategy, if you will, for affordable housing that we're not using, is the multifamily tax exemption. I know we talked about it through Central, but we just haven't quite gotten to use it yet. And so this might give us a chance to use this one. Are there, I wasn't going to unpack this one very far since you just saw a whole wonderful presentation a few weeks ago on this one. Okay. Inclusionary zoning. We already require this. This is that when a housing developer comes into the core of Central Issaquah, he also has, they also have to provide 10% of 80% or below in their project. We haven't had any housing developed in the core yet, so we haven't gotten to use this yet. But we're talking about, since it hasn't happened yet, do we have the ability to raise that number from 10% to something higher? And also, do we have the opportunity to take all of Central Issaquah and give that a requirement for inclusionary zoning? And so we're looking at some other jurisdictions that are doing this. Redmond, Sammamish, and Kirkland are using some form of it now. Bellevue used to require it, and now they don't require it, but they use incentives instead. And so we're trying to figure that out a little bit, if there's a way that works best for our community. But we're pretty excited about this, since part of it's already in place. Are there questions on inclusionary zoning?
Maybe that's a common phrase that's used, inclusionary zoning, but it seems to be a little obscure. I mean, something, you know.
It means, you know, it just means it's required.
Required. Right. I think label this issue something that's a little bit more descriptive of what we're really talking about would help.
So you like mandatory,
dialogue.
You want to be the hard.
Well, I'll leave it up to you to do that. But,
okay.
Yeah, that's. And this is a big deal.
Yes.
This would be a really big deal, and I wouldn't want anybody to miss it based upon the title.
The name, sure, sure. Any questions on this?
I think that's a good point. I think inclusionary seems to be a version of the word included, which means you can be here too.
You can.
And I think what we're saying is you
gotta. Okay, yeah. So you want something mandatory in there. Okay. Okay. Any other thoughts on this one? This is a crowd pleaser, the housing levy. This is the previous pieces the applicant would have to provide the funding for. And if this truly is a city problem, a community problem, this would be the time where the citizens would have to put in a little bit to help us with the housing problem. And it could fix all of these things. It could go to all of these things, from actually partnering for affordable housing creation to providing the land that we've done in the past for affordable housing. It can help with household assistance. It can help with seniors or rental, emergency rental assistance. It can help in a variety of ways. This is a list that I pulled from some of the Seattle levies that they've done. So we threw this in there as sort of so everybody has to help a little bit to help us help the community with the housing strategy. And so this would be the one that would be the residents would help, the citizens would help. And again, they would be able to vote on it so they could tell you whether they want to help or not. Are there questions on this one? Mm-hmm.
Has anyone done this in King County in the last, I don't know, 20 years?
I just know that Seattle has. I'm looking to Arthur. Is that a question that you can answer? I hear Kent did a bond 20 years ago? Okay, so no one's done anything more recent than 20 years? Okay. I know they've talked about it region-wide, but because we're doing the strategy now, we wanted to sort of put this forward now. As an idea, if the region doesn't do one, we're still thinking it might be a good idea for us. Any other thoughts on this one? So the next steps then. Wow, you guys are so quiet. Oh, Tola, okay.
If we're done with the various topics, I noticed that one of the ones in your checklist effectivity matrix that had the most checks by it, but that you didn't talk about, was an action of land acquisition. And could you at least briefly mention what's meant by that?
Right, and we were sort of double counting it by the acquisition of land could come from the housing levy. And so that's why we put this slide up instead of just having purchase of land, because we found, because this would be how we would purchase the land, because we don't have any land right now that we could use for that, other than the ones that are already in play, like the one in Highlands that's, you're already talking about, and
I'm not tracking. How okay. would purchasing land make more housing available? The city would become landlords? What?
Well, we like we did for the YWCA, where the land was donated or in some fashion, and then the applicant built the. And we've done that in other places where we've the land has been either at market rate or a different price, and then the builder can build on it, and that takes away that whole cost for the builder. So it's a partnership that we've done in the past.
Got it.
Like the Habitat for Humanity houses down at the end of Second. It was the city's land, and we sold it for a little cost, but then the builder got to not have to buy the land for that. So we've done that in a few different ways in the past. Any other questions on? So the end of the needs analysis, we're going to do some neighborhood outreach with the three commissions in April. We're working on a survey. We're probably going to do it online as well as be in a fun place like Andrea did, either at the depot or at the community center where you get lots of folks just walking by. And then we'd come back to you in May for another work session to let you know what all we've come up with and how the needs analysis ended up. And then step three is the policy conversation, where we actually sit down with some developers and master builders and say, you know, what do you guys think? How can we make this easier for all of us to fix this? So that'll be some good outreach with them. And then a work session with you all in June for updating on that. Are there questions on what comes next?
Mary Lou?
I appreciate your comments. So there was on March 2nd, the Growth Management Policy Board for PSOC had a session on affordable housing, and they used three keywords that I thought were kind of interesting: the preserve, improve, expand. Mm-hmm. Is that something that's typical in the housing strategy? Is that a way that we would structure our objectives? Have you heard that one before?
It certainly could. I mean, preserving the housing stock that we have is a good way to keep it, obviously. And we certainly have a lot downtown in Old Town, all the little houses, which is partly what the Old Town Subarea Plan is working on. Is there a way that makes it easier to keep those little houses? And so that would be the preserve part. So yeah, I think we're working on that in a couple of different ways. But we could certainly structure it that way if that's comfortable.
I just thought those themes were good, because one thing we don't want to do with our zoning is to lose some of the stock.
Right, absolutely.
And then the other comment was that this focus group and joint citizen committees, it's a great way to leverage all the
right.
knowledge and the interest that we have out there. So
right.
I'm not sure how many times we've done this before, but it seems like you got great outcomes from it.
All should be so proud of this community. There are, I mean, every community focus group, we'd walk out of there with our heads exploding on the passion and the excitement and the I mean, people are like digging in trying to solve the problems, and you just walk away thinking, wow. I mean, all of them were just fabulous. I was just very proud to be in this city, because they're everyone. And even the joint committees, too, they just are rolling up their sleeves thinking, we can do this. You know, their neighbors are affected. The people that they work with are affected. Their families are affected. And it just makes everybody want to just everybody move forward and figure out how to fix this.
That's great. And then my last comment about today's presentation, it was nice to have you distill it with words and give us some high-level themes. But you included so much data. I found the data extremely helpful.
It's amazing.
So thank you for putting both together in the
right.
same presentation. That was great.
Right. I thought you should have that before, because, it gets a little dry, all the charts. But it's fabulously interesting
Good.
How it all points sort of in the same direction. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Anything else? I'd like to talk a little bit on the preservation side, and Arthur, maybe latch into this a little bit. But one of the thoughts I have that I don't think has been tried much is we have housing like now that if somehow we can keep it, preserve it, but keep the rents where they are, kind of thing, and some sort of private partner, public partnership to somehow keep those rents where they are. Like, I know some people that have a couple of apartments, it's their retirement, and they're just going to keep increasing the rents as they go along, because that's the retirement problem. But if someone could guarantee them that some sort of subsidy for those increases where they could keep the rents where they are now, they may not seem real affordable now, but 5 years from now, they might be one of some of the most affordable units we could have, because
right.
if you don't put that inflation factor in there. So just a thought to look at that kind of possibility of getting some partnership with the folks that own things now
mm-hmm.
that could somehow lock things in be a fairly cheap way, I think, of getting something more long-term, not immediate for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And then just a question on some of the data as we went through all the charts I was looking at, and there's one that kind of caught my eye that I want to verify, and it was showing that both King County and Issaquah meet the 50 to 80% range of housing is met in King County and Issaquah as far as availability. And I'm going to have to dig out where which slide that was.
They meet the...
Yeah, we've met it. You know, we have that much housing available, not the
to
rents.
To meet the needs?
Yeah, to meet the needs. And it's been that way, it looks like, over time. I'm trying to have to look for it here.
This is the one where everything's going up, even rents. I'm not sure.
You can see it. It doesn't mention King County. It's on page 53 of 124. PDF.
I just hid them all at the end here.
Proportional need versus existing available.
Well, I got the fresher data highlights overall housing affordability, and there's the 50 to 80% range.
I'm not sure.
And now, unless I'm reading that graph wrong, I just wanted to check that out because it just didn't seem right.
It's a bar chart. no wages. Do you know which problem it's connected to?
Overall housing affordability.
The first one. So that's not a bar chart.
But it has King County.
This one is 52 of 132.
52.
Yeah.
This one? Single family home prices?
Oh, bar chart.
No.
Oh, bar chart. You're right. Sorry.
Where are you going?
Oh, I thought I tucked them all at the end here.
One of them is way at the end.
Keep going.
It's a three bar chart. Green, dark green, and yellow.
No, now they're all the second problem.
Go to the very end. Go to the very end.
Oh, and the refresher. Thank you, Bob.
I think it was earlier, but I just found it here quicker.
Whoops. That's from September.
There it was.
September.
You went past it.
Pressure.
No, that's not
I'm looking
sorry.
For the green
no,
one.
Wasn't it?
It looked like it.
Yeah,
but it wasn't it.
It just had the wrong color. There it is. Yeah.
There you go. In the 50 to 80% range.
Thank you. Wow, it takes a village.
Existing supply of affordable for each group, and so each group there is a car and so forth. It looked like...
So this shows that in King County, they have a lot more between 50 and 80 than anybody else.
But the dark green is the needs.
Right.
And the light green is what there actually is. So it looks like we far exceed, right?
So on the very next slide, it's actually, you have just numbers. And our proportionate need, as far as our population within Issaquah, if you look down there, is 16%, and our existing affordability is 15% in that range. You see that bottom row
right.
in the middle table?
Yeah.
And I think that's what that bar chart represents.
Right. Well. So that's for Issaquah.
That range, 50 to 80% AMI.
Right. So that's one range. It shows everything else is showing we're way short of it. Just like that piece
right.
there, we're at or above. Well, we're just below in Issaquah, but in King County as a whole.
Right.
Sufficient to meet the needs by quite a bit.
Right.
It felt weird to me, so I'm just trying to see
right.
if I'm reading
and I'll have to look into this. This one's from Eco Northwest that presented in September. And so I'll have to dig into that to see, because that does seem odd that we would be right up
yeah,
there.
Yeah, so I think the challenge is it's not equally distributed throughout the county.
Yeah.
So if you go to South King County, like Auburn, a couple of those communities would say they got plenty of affordable housing.
Preservation's not the issue.
But even at some point.
Okay.
There's Arthur. There you go. That's why I was trying to get Arthur up here one way or another. I figured I'd finally succeed.
Hi, for your audience and Arthur Sullivan, Program Manager of ARCH. There's a couple things to keep in mind when you look at that, because at first blush, it is a response to have. But first, you have to keep in mind how far you are below for under 50% of median, and that a lot. And then the other thing you have to also understand in that other slide where you showed the graph of 50 to 80% of median, that's none of that, very few of that is ownership housing. It's almost all rental housing. And what's happened is a lot of it has skewed towards the 80% of median versus the 50% of median. So what you're seeing is that the total undersupply is putting a lot of pressure, especially between 50 and 60-65% of median affordable rents, plus you don't have much of that. So you really need to dive into it a little bit deeper, because on first blush it says, do we need to worry about that 50 to 80% income range? And the issue is, especially for rental, that's a really wide swath, and the distribution within there is a little bit skewed, much closer to the 80% level.
It's probably meaning the 75 to 80%, but the right. 50 to 75 is probably.
So, for example, if you look at your incentives when we designed your CIP program, your units under affordability are between 50 and 80, but you decided, because when looking at some of the data, you wanted to get down to 70% and 60% of median, because you realized if you were right at 80% of median, you were probably relatively close to market. So that was one reason when we defined the CIP. And what other cities on the east side are doing more frequently now with their land use incentive programs is they're trying to find ways to get their programs more in the 50, 60, or 70 rather than the 70 and the 80%. Does that help address your question?
Yes, thank you.
Other comments or questions, Paul?
Yeah, I just a couple comments. Sometime last year, I worked with the numbers a little bit, and I think I think in our comprehensive plan, still we even say, or somewhere, it's one of those documents that at 80% AMI and below, if the distribution of our population and the proportional need totals to 40%, then our goal would to have housing availability that matches that 40%. And I think I figured out that over the next 2 or 3 years, that 140% of all the homes to be built would have to be affordable for us to get to that number. In other words, it was not attainable.
Right.
And I think that's a real eye opener, and that's something we have to set goals that are achievable. And then actually really make a difference. Right now, we just have a target of 40%, but I think we have to rethink that goal and put together a plan that's actually achievable. And we have to improve upon where we are. And actually, thank you, Bill, for your questions, because I was gonna make, if you go to the next chart, that was one of the points that I just wanted to pull out here, was that if you look at the very low, again, I'm looking at the middle table, the very low and the low, if our proportionate need is 12% in each of those areas, but it's only 3% of our existing availability, and there's probably a deeper story in that, even more rental as opposed to ownership, I get that. I think that is still, you know, we are probably looking at household incomes that map really well to you know, people with their first jobs. And people fulfilling, you know, many of the service jobs that we have here in town. So I was going to mention that I think a focus here. And I think also there's an element here for us to set as a priority that something like 40% of our available stock should be proportionate to what's in here. I mean, that's a huge statement about our community and the values that we hold. And I think in this, let's make sure that we're kind of checking that. I think it's very important, but I want to make sure, as everybody, you know, journeys with us as we work toward refining this strategy, that we remind people that is at least one of the goals that we have right now, is to try to provide housing in an affordable range as proportionate to what's currently the need is within the community.
And just to speak to the King County number, it's in the King County wide planning policies, and King County knows that it's aspirational and that it's, as you said, impossible for all the communities to reach those numbers, but they keep them in there because it is such a community problem and issue that that they do set that as an aspirational. And some communities, like to the south, they do really well at some kinds of housings that we don't do well at. And so instead of having all the different jurisdictions have different kind of goals, we can still do that internally for our own. But that's why these King County goals are in everybody's comprehensive plan, because they're aspirational for the county.
Thank you. And the one last point I wanted to make, it was, and again, Bill, I want to thank you for bringing this up, was the concept of preservation. I didn't hear a lot of words, a lot about that this evening, but just that preservation of housing, you know, affordable in certain ranges. I've heard testimony from people, planners and electeds who live in the south part of the county. Yeah, you know, preservation of that stock in those ranges isn't as much of an issue, but when I sat on the Joint Recommendation Committee for a couple years, it was very clear in the East King County and north parts of the county that is a major issue for us. And I hope that as we move forward in developing this, that a clear identification and strategies to address the preservation of housing affordable in those certain ranges is, should be part of what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. Other thoughts?
Anything else?
Okay. Thank
Excellent.
You. See
great.
You soon.
Great. Great status, and thank you for bringing lots of detail, which is awesome. We're getting there.
Yeah, we're getting there. Thank you, Arthur.
Next item on the agenda is Agenda Bill 7306, Capital Budget Policy. We're circling back around here before we do the finish line. Jennifer Olson, our finance director, is here.
Thank you. As part of tonight's discussion, I wanted to refer the council to some additional documents that were added to the work session packet. And that was a redlined version of the proposed policy that that we included comments that occurred at the last council's work session, and that was on February 13th. I wanted to thank Christina and Emily for having that conversation with the council. I was in Minnesota, and I have a new grandson. So,
congratulations.
Thank you. So what I wanted to do tonight in the essence of time is to go through what some of those proposed changes were to ensure that the conversation was captured with some of the proposed changes to the red font. And the format with regards to this proposed policy was done so that the red font was the areas where we needed to have council set direction, whether it was a target or some wordsmithing that needed to be done. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to go through what those changes were, and then open it up to any other questions, thoughts, feedback on the proposed policy, and then we can move forward in that fashion if that's agreeable. So with regards to the section on capital budget objectives, there were comments about maybe changing the word dynamic, and so that second bullet point, that was changed to priorities as community conditions changed. So to make it clear that the objective was that that we would ensure that when the community's expectations change, that that we would include that in our capital budgeting discussions. Then again, the third bullet point was to ensure appropriate planning efforts were aligned with those changing demands. So that kind of connects with that second bullet. And then that last bullet point was changing the word capable to able. So that maintain a high quality service infrastructure able of meeting community needs today and in the future. In the capital improvement plan section, one of the areas for the council to provide direction was in the area of the time span of the capital improvement plan. And what was proposed for the council to consider was a span of 6 to 10 years. And it's my understanding that essentially that was something that we ought to consider that 5-year plan with a future outlook to 10 years. It's very difficult to plan for 10 years, but we want to make sure that we're looking at the capital budget from a long-term perspective. And so the CIP would essentially establish projects within that 5-year time frame, but would also give the council some information on that future 5 years. And so that change in the wording has been proposed that it would essentially be a period of the 5 years with a new outlook. As part of that first paragraph in that section, also there was a proposal or an idea that the capital budget would be on an annual basis. However, for planning purposes and for public engagement purposes, what's being proposed is that it would be done in a biennial framework. And so that annual was changed to biennial. And that biennial change then was then incorporated into the next paragraph.
So I don't recall, I mean, let me refresh my memory. I don't know that we I think I recall from the work session that we talked about one of the options was biennial, and so now this is actually coming forward as a recommendation?
Correct.
Okay.
This was a piece that I think got lost in translation and the back and forth between the different council meetings and then between us. And I think that was our intent, was to make that a recommendation. The thought being what Jen has laid out here, it allows for some more intensive public engagement efforts in the off year that would then allow us to better develop those sponsored and desired projects from the public. Also, the point that I would make, having utilized one of these rating processes and slightly more complex capital improvement plans, is the capital projects don't change, most of them don't change every year, so to go through the administrative work every year becomes incredibly taxing, not only for staff, but for council too. So I think the recommendation would be to, in that off year, again, focus on including new projects or any projects that have substantially changed in some way, and then re-rating those projects, but not going through the entire list of projects.
Thanks, Emily. So not that I know much about whether or not we should be looking at a biennial budget as well. Is this a baby step towards this, or could we make this step and still have an annual budget? Or is this sort of a baby step?
They're separate mm-hmm. considerations. It doesn't help, nor does it hurt, in my mind. So I'm not sure we're even at baby. It's sort of... Sure. No, pre-baby, embryonic.
Thanks, Bill.
So I would just ask in addition to that, so in the second year of it, as we put our budget together, we would still be using now the CIP, which is technically a year old. And so if we looked at it as the council was doing our budgeting and we wanted to take some things off there or move them around a little bit, I just want to make sure how much flexibility we would have to do that without having gone through, you know, it's like next year we'll do the public process, but you know, things could change, like say grants and things come up, and also we want to shift something forward and something back, and would that work okay?
Yep, we would use that opportunity, the annual operating budget conversation, to point out any changes that we would recommend on the capital plan and the incorporation of that new year one, and council would have the opportunity to discuss those projects or others and make modifications.
Thanks, Emily. All right, then in the section under the CIP criteria and ranking, the referral to an exhibit has been removed with language in there that it would be defined under administrative procedures and utilized by the council. So that would give flexibility in the ranking in the priority. So as they change, it would be known and it would be part of a published document that the public could find, but that it wouldn't necessarily be included within policy, but that known that it would be utilized as a way to understand how projects are set in place in the capital budget from year to year. And then moving on to the next change is actually in the project sources section under the project sources and uses identification. And that was a proposal to add in to seek out private contributions and donations as a funding strategy.
We're not just asking them for money so that we can do something, but during a private building process, it's more like a P3 project where we're both in it. And does it include that or exclude that, the current language?
Well, the policy doesn't specifically speak to public-private partnerships, but one would infer that would likely be the case, that if we were seeking that private contribution, that it it may be that. If that's something that we want to add to the policy, to kind of connect that to a private contributions or donations within a public-private partnership, we could maybe add those words.
I think if the words you have are adequate to not preclude a P3 style project, then I'm fine with the way it is. Okay. I just wasn't sure if it was part of that.
Okay, so. Good. The
is there an update?
This was in the packet. Mm-hmm. There was the agenda bill, and then there was a new addition. It's called View Proposed Policy Redline, January 2017.
It starts on the one we're reviewing tonight. Starts on page 95. Yeah, me too. This is printed from the website.
Yeah, it was the website copy was updated.
Yes, I'm on the Document Center.
I had downloaded it.
It's not on Friday. It's not
version.
In Fridays.
Probably downloaded it earlier. First came out. It was updated on the 11th.
To make sure we get updated versions if it's updated on the website. Okay. Did you find it now? Okay. Starts on page 95
okay.
of the packet that's online today.
In the section under project costs, there is the proposal for the difference between distinguishing capital outlay with capital projects, and that was capital outlay would be that $5,000 to the $49,999. What has been added here is that and or having less than so that there was flexibility in the type of project that would be considered capital outlay, and the type of project that would be considered capital project, and that is the proposed changes there. And then, yes.
Just from the council member point of view, we will see some projects on the CIP, mm-hmm. and we will see others as line items in the budget.
That is correct.
We still see everything, but they're not all on the CIP.
Yes, you'll see the capital budget. That's in the beginning part of the year, and then there will be some capital outlay, so there would be minor projects. So consider that to be kind of a mini capital budget within the operating budget.
Great, thanks.
And then I just got another question with that, which is fine. I just wonder, there's a gap there on the useful life, less than 3 years and greater than 5 years. And I know most things in my knowledge is 3 years and 5 years. And I can't think of anything that's 4 years, but we do have a little gap in there. What would you do if something was 4 years?
Well, the goal with useful life, I mean, that's probably the tough one, is that there can be a capital project. I mean, most capital projects are going to last longer than 5 years.
Bill, thanks for pointing that out. I think both references should be 5 years.
They should. Okay. They shouldn't have that gap there.
Yeah. Sure, we'll make that change.
Sure.
Thank you. I don't care if it's 3 or 5.
Okay. Let's see, and the last change then is adding language with regards to using, under the planning process, utilizing the public engagement toolkit to start to connect some of the things that we're doing for public engagement. And so that is the changes that were provided. Is there anything else, Emily or Christina, that I'm missing? So questions?
Questions? Not what's the next step, Jen?
The next step for consideration of this policy is the April 3rd council meeting. That would continue the public hearing that was conducted at the last city council meeting, and that would be where the council would be considering adopting the capital budget policy.
Anything else? Thank you very much. Right.
Thank you.
Next item, Agenda Bill 7312, the 2017 Regional Agenda, presented by Bob Harrison. And Maya Knox.
Good evening, I'm Maya Knox, Management Analyst and Fellow.
Maya.
Hey. So I'm here today to share administration's 2017 updates to the regional agenda. You'll probably remember this pretty well. It hasn't been too long since we've done it. But I just put together a quick PowerPoint show just to review some of the updates. So these are the underlying principles that went into the regional agenda document when we put it together last year. They haven't changed. So it's leadership on regional policymaking boards, participation in regional partnerships and collaborations, and connections with quality schools. The goals as well have stayed the same. We have 8 goals. The first one is on transportation. The second one is on public safety. We have a third goal on growth management, and then housing, economic development, the environment, human services, and schools. So I just did a rundown of what's changed from 2016 to 2017, and we can kind of discuss these as we go if you have questions, or we could save them for the end. I don't have a preference, whatever you guys prefer. Just let me know.
Topic by topic, but we'll probably ask questions as we go.
Yeah.
And then there's also sort of the straw man proposed changes to, is that in here somewhere? Handbook policy.
Yeah, it's in.
Okay.
It's just not in red.
Right.
Yeah. It should say draft, right?
Yeah.
So we have the actual agenda, and then we also have on page 117, 16, and 17, proposed new language. I think all of it was copied and pasted from existing documents except the appointments part. Is that correct, Bob?
Yes.
And then
essentially it's like a new policy for the council manual.
Right. So it's called appointments, and Bob and I worked on it together, and it's just a place to start. And so when we get to that, Bob or I can introduce it, and then we can talk about it.
So you want to do that at the end?
Probably.
Okay.
Sure.
Not about particular policy, but just in the introductory material to mm-hmm. each of the categories, the goals, I think it's the goals, all show up and track changes as new, but they're not new, right?
They're not new. I don't know why they're showing up that way.
So my question just was, I knew they weren't new, but are they?
Oh, there wasn't initially that overview of the goals. Yeah. So we just put that in there to kind of give like a, you know, 1,000-foot view.
We did not have that in the old version?
We had the goals, the same wording throughout the document. We just didn't have the summary right there.
Like a formatting change.
Okay, because that was my question. I actually thought we had that in last year's version.
We didn't know.
We did not. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. So let's get started with transportation. The major changes have been that the King County Long Range Plan was adopted, so we had some strategies that related specifically to that and influencing that. So those are crossed out. ST3 passed, so now we're focused more on implementation and how to get kind of what we're looking for in the implementation part of that. We have an emphasis on our legislative agenda of lobbying for SR18 improvements, and that comes out in the regional agenda as well. And then one of the new things for this year and last year is regional transportation summits as a new venue for some of these regional partnership conversations that we're having.
Possible to put the the chart with the track changes on the screen?
Well, I think you can pick between the PowerPoint and the track changes.
Oh, okay.
Well, let's see. Yeah, I do have it up here though.
That's helpful, yeah. Yeah. So are we going to start with?
Do you want to go down?
No, oh. Start with A.
Okay.
Start from the top and talk about the.
I wanted to go right up to the goal.
Oh, sure.
So this was, I know we spent hours on this last year, enhance regional mobility and road service levels to encourage sustainable community. It has a real regional flavor to it.
Mm-hmm. And it doesn't have very much of an Issaquah flavor to it. The thing that kind of jumped out at me is, how does the council feel about minimizing or eliminating pass-through traffic in Issaquah? That's not reflected in it. So we can go out regionally and advocate for what you see in Goal 1, but will we be able to better our current problem of pass-through traffic doing that?
Proposed language?
Yep. And minimize or eliminate pass-through traffic in Issaquah, adding it to it. Because I think it is...
As like a sub, like a C or
no, as, a,
as
goal,
a goal?
As part of the goal. Mike, it's more of a question to the fellow council members. Where do you feel you are on this? When you read this agenda and you think about Issaquah, if we do everything on the agenda, where are we with regional pass-through traffic? Do we still have it? Are we working to get rid of it? Are we working to minimize it? Are we going to look at local, if we're going to look at local transportation options to minimize it, shouldn't we state that one of the things we're out there doing when we're in the community is saying we want this to not grow, not go from 30,000 cars on Front Street a day to 50. We want less than 30,000. We'd love none. Is that something? Because if we just go out and lobby for the region, we're just taking the status quo that we're a pass-through town. It's a question to the council.
Well, and you look at the sub, you know, the sub objectives. The second one, improve traffic flow and safety on regional roads serving Issaquah. And so if you improve the traffic flow on regional roads, that's, I don't know what serving Issaquah means, but one could argue you're just going
to
get more cars here faster, which is one of the things we've talked about is just been a topic.
So this is our regional agenda, it's with our regional partners, but through the Issaquah lens, are the things on here going to improve our town or the region?
B, I don't read B and read that as just create a bigger funnel so that people can make
drive
a parking lot in the city. I view it as traffic flow and safety on regional roads serving Issaquah. I think of that as those roads passing through Issaquah as well. So Highway 900 and East Lake Sam, Issaquah Hobart Road becoming Front Street. So I don't know if we have exactly the right mix mm-hmm. on how we want to do improvements, but to me that is a big part of what mm-hmm. you're talking about.
Well, at the very least, it suggests that if you and I look at it and see there are different ways to read it, then it's probably not the exact words that we want.
So, for example, if we've already approved money to study traffic on Issaquah Hobart Road. If the county and the surrounding cities come back and say the best thing for the region is to make it a four-lane road with roundabouts feeding into Front and Newport and Sunset, are we going to advocate for that in the region?
That would only improve part of the traffic flow.
Right.
Right. So it wouldn't achieve that.
Right. So I guess my sense is I'm not sure that I want us to go out and have a consistent message in the region. And so when I'm out there, I tell people bringing more cars into Issaquah is not the answer. Getting people to where they need to go faster is the answer. And so what voice do you bring to the table when you're sitting down and talking with people? And I'm not sure I got that in here. This to me looks like there's a lot going on in the region and we're going to have a seat at the table, but it doesn't really tell me what our message is when we have our seat at the table.
I mean, if for instance, if the state wanted to expand Highway 900 mm-hmm. and improve it and create it such that as it flows through Issaquah, it could take twice as much traffic. Right. And then de-emphasize Issaquah-Hobart Road streets. Because they then have a major conduit. That would be an example of a little win.
Yes, it would.
I don't know how we. It sounds like everybody sort of likes that idea. So how do we have language here that reflects those sorts of that's the sort of outcomes? Because when you talk about reducing traffic in, I worry about how that. We need regional solutions that get people to their jobs and whatnot and. That may be taking people off some roads and putting them onto others or getting them off roads and into mass transit or whatever. Right?
So it's maybe not even something we could get through tonight. What I'm not sure of is that when we're all out at our different meetings and all sitting at different tables, that we all clearly know what we want to say out there. And for me, just as one council member, I say no more cars coming through Issaquah. I say we've taken our fair share. We actually have to do better at managing what's in town now. But I'm one person, and I am not sure that what I see in here right now is a message, a consistent message that we would all, majority of us would say, let's go carry that one out. But I also think it's too big of a lift tonight to say what that might look like. I just want to put that out there.
So I think that's a great discussion to have, actually. And I want to read B. But I appreciate you have that up there. It says, you know, there's I see improve regional. Mm-hmm. And what does improve mean? It could be, I think the regional network around here is too fragile. So there's a bump on 900 and we suffer. There's a bump on 18 and we suffer. It's too fragile, right? And so improvement just can be make the local network that serves us and the choices that people make, whether they live here or they pass through here, more resilient to when there are issues. And that would be a dramatic improvement. So to me, regional includes 18. That's a part of this as well. And so certainly more resilient. And I look at it another way too, is that, and again, I'm going to go back to, I mentioned this before, it used to be that the state would park tow trucks on each end of the floating bridges, so as soon as there was an incident, they would rush out there so they could clear it up and get it out and get people flowing again. And it seems to me that, boy, you know, when there's something, wouldn't it be great if something happened on the Issaquah-Hobart Road and the county zoomed down there and removed that, you know, that blockage that shouldn't be there, so even our residents can get to their destination better. And so this idea of resiliency and being and having greater responsiveness to issues, is as much as, you know, to me, 18 is about capacity as well, not only safety, but capacity. So I think it's a mix of capacity, resiliency, and responsiveness to issues. And so, and I do look at it as regional. So that's everything that's in my mind when I look at B. It's improve regional, and do we identify in here actionable items for the upcoming year that would work toward those goals? Yeah, I think that would be we could probably talk through it that way and have that conversation. Anyway, so there's my two cents on what I think about when I think about the regional road network. But I guess I'll just repeat one more time. I'm concerned when I hear language about reduce. I understand the intent, but that also will have an absolute direct impact on our own residents' ability to get through. The amount that can get through is less, then I would have to see how that actually would be a true improvement to those this is their destination.
That's a good point. And just to feed on that a little bit. So first on the regional piece. So where it says on the far right-hand column, 2006, King County, blah, 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 to define the regional road network. I actually wondered if what we want is more than that. Do we want it to be defined and prioritized? Meaning the biggest bang for the buck for Issaquah would be for 18 and 90, and Highway 18 between 90 and Issaquah-Hobart Road, and SR 900 and 169 to be fixed. Those are big things for Issaquah and the region. So it's not just, you know, this is what our regional network is. We really need to advocate for projects that get done that also benefit us. And on a local level, I guess there is a piece of me that thinks that some of the way we have done our planning and maybe continue to do our planning is we focus on getting a lot of, we try to focus on getting traffic through town faster to the south at the expense of cross traffic, meaning it can be really hard to go from east to west at that time because everything is set up to move you north to south. And so local residents moving around town, actually, I don't know that they're prioritized in the way we approach traffic management in town now. I think they're secondary. And so I think it's kind of when you open the door and you say our priority is to move north to south faster, I think that's a detriment to people who live here and are just trying to pick up kids from school or get them to a park or do something like that. So I see that as slightly different. I see the regional traffic that passes through in town now uses us as a part of the regional network. I want that piece removed. And I think telling people that we're going to, our big plan is to lobby to get these big projects moved up and in 10 or 15 years we'll see improvement. I think we need a second piece to that. I don't think that's reasonable. And that my concern is that here we're doing the same thing we've always done, which is say, let's sit at the table and talk about these big projects. But today, people can't get across town. And so saying that that's what we're going to do, to me, is one story. The other story is we have to do something in town now. And what we do will affect regional traffic when we do it. So I'm not sure that's enough for me personally, looking at it. I think it just says we're going to stay with the status quo until some of these big projects get done. And also, what message are we saying when we're sitting out there on the table? That we're okay with the way it is and we'll wait for 18 to get done? That's a decade or two away. Long.
Okay, so let's start at the top. The goal. Are we going to change the actual goal?
I can do that today.
No, I'll make a comment to your thoughts before we hit that. And that's just kind of what a couple of things have been said here is that, but the numbers show 1,500 people stay here for the day. 20,000 are going out and 15,000 are coming in. So of those people that are coming out and going in, they're Issaquah residents. You know, so we are contributing as much to that regional traffic problem as anyone else is because everybody's doing that, as all the data shows. So, you know, we have to own that part of the problem ourselves because we're the ones trying to get places as well. So we're our own passive traffic in a sense. I mean, I pass it through Issaquah to get out the other end and through there too. So just bring that side in.
Raya?
It seems like with the goal, just one thought is maybe to add something that's more focused on Issaquah. Something maybe at the end that would talk about to ensure that Issaquah's needs are met. It seems like, not to jump ahead, but the second page of transportation where we were talking about preserving and improving existing transit service levels and ensure that the needs and interests of Issaquah are addressed within the King County Metro Long Range Plan. And a lot of that has changed and we've moved that over, but we seem to lack things that are more focused on Issaquah or the language, I guess I would say.
So you're thinking the actual goal one itself could have something that mentions
potentially
Issaquah?
that is more focused on Issaquah, because I think that that's a really good start. It maybe we just need to expand.
Okay.
It.
So as we go through here, how would you all like to do this? Because if we wordsmith we've got several pages, and if we wordsmith everything, we're going to be here a long time. Or do we want notes taken with the administration bringing back recommended language?
What kind of time frame are we shooting for?
30 minutes.
To complete this?
A half an hour, we're supposed to be done at 8.
Oh, no,
half an hour from now?
I meant the update, the complete the update.
Approved
in 2017.
Yeah. So we could make comments, you know, substantive comments tonight, and then we could have another draft come back.
Yeah.
I'm not super excited about having this be done in the middle of the year. This doesn't seem like that.
What was that?
The middle of the year each year. It would be nice to have it start this toward the end of prior year. Get it ready for that. That's just a comment. It's not a criticism. It's a comment. Because if we were to have it come back in April and then it doesn't get adopted till May, I mean, you're halfway through the year. It just seems practically at some point we want to roll this back so our process is a little sooner.
I missed those words. You're right. I didn't look so much at the strikeout, but really, honestly, the framework that would work for me.
So I want to go back to what are we going to
do today?
Yeah. What do we want to accomplish tonight?
So I agree that we should go through and make comments. I think I agree with you that wordsmithing it tonight, we'll turn it into wordsmithing it still tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Maybe this is a suggestion may throw out. A lot of these sections do logically align with some of the committees that we have. I know this may talk about extending it, but taking transportation to infrastructure, taking growth to your committee. There's public safety into services. There's parks into services. And maybe by breaking it apart and having a session, I'm sure all of those committees have plenty of time slots available on their upcoming agendas. Or maybe not. So I'm just, that would just be one way to each section getting more in-depth scrutiny, but to break it up so we can get through it a little bit faster. Just a suggestion.
I have to go back to the beginning of the, it was to come to returning the full council on March 20th, so clearly that wouldn't work. So we would have to discuss tonight, and then it would come back to the council and then get referred to the committees. Is that the process?
When the council came here.
Yeah, then we'd have to go back to council to refer it, which we could do easily on Monday. Okay.
So another, just want to throw out there.
I had another thought too.
Well, transportation, we don't really know yet if there's going to be as much conversation required by the other sections. Maybe it's just one or two that are going to be dominating.
Well, so we have a couple choices. We could go through each one of these tonight and gather comments from fellow council members, or we could just send it to the council tonight and have the committees do their in-depth reviews of the sections that are appropriate. And not, that seems like double duty. You're either going to go through it here or you're going to go through it there. Mary Lou?
Sure. Since everybody doesn't get to sit on every committee and participate, maybe instead of wordsmithing, just thoughts. Mm-hmm. Just thoughts. And then it goes to committee, and at least people have heard and gotten some direction from the other council members. Just thoughts.
I like that.
I like that too. And okay. I think like a thought for this one is somehow include some local mobility in here, something a little
local
more specific.
Yeah, I was thinking,
you know,
at the end of the goal, just saying
somehow
and improving mobility and addressing the mobility needs and interests of this you're right.
Regional.
Totally did it for me.
Okay. Yeah. Any other comments on the transportation? Oh, I guess we probably. There's a lot of red. So if you have comments for the transportation for CIC, excuse me, to consider.
I do. Just on the light on the status side. The proposed end of the line is in Central Esquerra. I actually really think what we should say is we're going to start the conversation of what it means to be the proposed end. That's just a statement, but it's really hard to assess what zones you put the sound transit use in. We haven't adjusted our code yet. We haven't really even talked about what it means to be the end of the line. And I think in order to sit down with sound transit and talk about this, we have to understand what that means. It could be a really big deal.
That's a really good point.
You know what the actual language is that passed in ST3? This says, makes it sound like the language that passed is the proposed end of the line is in the Central Esquire area. Do we know
it? I don't think that's in
there. So I can get that for you.
I just can't.
Yeah, we'll get it for the next.
Okay.
But I think you're, you know, approximately right. I think one of the things that you, I'm listening to the council this evening, that you've kind of put your fingers on that I've, as I look at this, so the objective is really the long game. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you're really looking at that and you're looking at multi-year. So, you know, the first one on there is 2041. Mm-hmm. And then when we talk about the status, they're kind of like, and the action steps are 1 year window. So when you talked about public, you know, public works managers task force in 2017 under B. Mm-hmm. So there's a second phase to that, which I know, but it's not reflected in this, which is there's going to be an elected component to this, an elected committee that the kind of the staff will report out, and there will be policy conversation regionally around this kind of elected, and a lot of that work will get done in 2018, which I was listening to the conversation, that's not even reflected on there, so you don't know that. So somehow we need to, I need to think about maybe how we translate some of the long game into the status reports, because it is more than 1 year, but we adopt this on an annual basis. So maybe as we walk through this conversation in committee, we can think about some of these status reports are really 2 to 3 year implementation phases rather than just, even though we're looking at it on a 1 year picture.
So that's a really good observation. I was going to
do that at the end.
Yeah. Okay. Yep.
Yes. We'll do it at the end. Let's do, because we've got this, and then we've got the appointments that we need to get through.
Process. Yeah.
Okay. Transportation or CIC.
Is that what you're saying?
More comments.
Yeah.
Direction.
Yeah. What? The transportation part? Yeah. Or, and you're on CIC, right? You're the chair,
yeah.
So.
Yeah. So it's mine.
Okay. Anybody else?
Can we, well, we had A up there and then B.
Yeah, B?
Yep.
Yes, I forgot there was just that one. I'm looking at the whole thing. Okay. Let's move on to C. We're not getting any comments.
C is gone.
Oh, well, there was a C, sorry. One strike C. Okay, let's go to public safety, number two. Comments for services and safety.
Oh, public safety? Yeah, I had one comment.
Okay.
So I guess I just didn't understand how EFER fits into this public safety piece. Is this more about communications or? I just didn't understand how fire services fit in, or if they did. Because a lot of this in here is communication, right?
So EFER has a bullet right below this one, which is B.
Yeah, but that's EFER's operations. On the emergency response side, are they at the table for this piece? No.
So this was primarily on the police and police and communication side. Now, EFER is there for a component of the regional radio network because NORCOM is represented. They're part of NORCOM.
Which one is that? Is that PSEM? Or what
so it's the, it's the Public Safety Emergency Response Network.
Okay. So should we list them as a partner? And the other question would be, should we tighten up the objective to say it's not emergency response infrastructure and plan for emergency response services? Is it really police response and radio communications?
So I think what you're hearing is want services and dig in more to make sure that this is.
And services has, remember, services,
okay.
which helps
awesome.
That conversation.
So should they maybe be on listed as a partner?
Yeah, spell out EBSCO.
Do our interests align, I guess.
So I have a couple of things that I think, one that we have an action that we want to do for sure, and under this category, and one that's a maybe. The for sure is we need to take a look at the state, the results from the the response to the Cascadia subduction event exercise. Cascadia Rising, thank you. Those results, I believe, came out today or yesterday or thereabouts. And so I think as a city, we want to take a look and see which of those we want to have apply to us. And the second is one that, and this is, I've said this before, but I'll say it again. This issue of solar weather and the fact that the Western United States has the ability to disconnect from the power grid on the eastern part of the United States. There was an event in the mid-1800s that if it happened today would blow out the entire power system in the United States, and there are components in the network that would be years before they would get rebuilt. And what you do in response to that, so that the U.S. government maintains a solar weather forecasting for what things that are happening from, basically what happens is the sun puts out what's called a coronal mass ejection, and it hits the atmosphere and it creates voltage potentials across the United States, and the longer the run lines, the higher the currents that occur as a result of it. And scientific experts, this is to me, it's not as dire as global warming, but it is the next thing that is up and coming that as a public policy issue. Because, like I said, there was one in the mid-1800s. If it happened today, the entire, at least the eastern part of the U.S. power system would be wiped out. And so I continue to have an interest in knowing that the power suppliers in the western U.S., I know the city got a response back from the power, Puget Sound Energy, thank you. But I still don't feel like it answers the questions, which is what happens if tomorrow the U.S. government says there's a coronal mass ejection, it's called a level 10, they have a 10-level system, and the level 10 is the one that would create substantial power problems. But really, scientific experts say years to rebuild the power system if one of these substantial coronal mass ejections happen again. And all you have to do is disconnect the major networks and go to more regional networks. There are issues around it, there are operational issues, but there are things you can do, and it would prevent catastrophic power failures. So I continue to want to see, as a municipality, have us be involved in a conversation. And part of this is because I have a day job that looks at some of these larger scale emergency response issues, but I would like to see us help drive a conversation where Washington State municipalities help make sure that they really have a system in place where they, in response to one of these CMEs, would actually disconnect off the national grid.
So is it a missing action on here, is what you're saying? Energy resiliency is a missing action stuff?
Yes. I think it would be work with, potentially with AWC, to drive a conversation with the energy companies, a more comprehensive conversation on do they have steps in place. I think since we're having a conversation about a Cascadia subduction event, right? More recently than the last subduction event was an event that would destroy the United States power grid if not responded to in a super timely fashion, like 12 hours, 24 hours kind of a thing. That's the kind of time frame that you have warning that a CME is on its way towards the earth.
So one of my questions would be, about that.
Not many people do.
And I still don't. I'm sure it's critical to know about that. My understanding of a regional agenda is that something that we put resources to in a specific year that we think are items that we assign resources to, council members, staff, and I'm wondering if it's if this is the year to assign resources to that objective.
This is one of those ones where it doesn't take a lot of resources to go start the ball rolling with, for instance, I mean, I'm not involved with the AWC, right? Mm-hmm. I'm just involved with Sound Cities, and it's a large, it's an AWC level issue, not an SCA level issue. But somebody, I believe, should be starting that conversation.
So it's a conversation that...
Because I'm proud that we did Cascadia Rising. But this is, to my way of thinking, an equally significant risk, regional risk, to fundamental damage to our infrastructure.
Okay.
Go after you, Phil.
I just, we should adopt a policy stating our, that we are against coronal mass ejections.
Because that'll do it.
I mean, yeah, this is, we need to take a stance.
So I actually just wanted to say, I actually think that Tola has a good idea. It's so big and huge, I don't quite get what he's talking about, but energy resiliency, while we do not provide, we're not a utility that provides power, I think we should have energy resiliency on there. And I know the Chamber of Commerce now is working to support the Energize East Side project, which we don't know much about. Mm-hmm. And so maybe, maybe it should get on there as an action, and the status for this year will be something very minimal. It might just be that a council member decides to step up and get some more information on it. But I think energy resiliency is a community concern.
Well, yeah, we've also had emails, concerns about
brownouts and blackouts.
And unnecessary, unexplained power issues. So when you were talking, Tola, I was also thinking that, yes, are we missing some sort of a objective on there?
Say, if you look up Carrington event, was the event in the 1800s, where they say if it happened today, it would be years, parts of the United States would be years before they had central power returned.
I support adding energy resiliency.
You can take up at,
I do too.
You get to take up that at services, getting support from your fellow council members. Okay, anything else on public safety? E, on public safety. I just wasn't sure when we've had a conversation publicly talked about fire station location off East Lake Sam.
Bill asked me if we've talked about it in E for, I don't think we have at our. That there's a proposal to look at, I would call it a north of 90 location. I don't know. At the board level, we've actually said East Lake. You remember, Paul, last year?
No, you know, I don't recall speaking about it at the board meeting at all. I do recall
here, but I don't know if it was what meeting.
What venue?
Yeah, or so she's talking about the comment team to discuss opportunities.
That's the last bullet you're talking about up there. So the city did acquire some property off of East Lake Sam, and we've had conversation with the fire chief about looking at that. And so the administration was planning on putting together a work team with EFER to look at what that may mean and how service would be provided to the community, and particularly as it relates to the Kalani station that we get a lot of service to Providence Point from, and we pay a significant amount of that station. So there's some additional, you know, regional impacts to that too. But it's still very preliminary. We've just had a conceptual conversation with the chief, and then the next goal would be, and to get that staff team together and then have a conversation, I think, at the various boards. But it is really driven first by the city, since we're responsible for building the station.
So a question, Bob, on efficiency versus growth, because we want to look at our current service and make sure it's being most efficiently and economically provided. Is the new station a growth related or an efficiency, current efficiency related item?
So I think there's opportunities for both.
Okay.
Yeah, both categories.
Then I'm in favor of having something up there, just maybe not something that says that based on growth and based on improving efficiencies, the city's going to talk about something. I mean, I just don't think the public even knows, or even some EFER board members know, that it's going to be on East Lake Sam Parkway, or
so
could
it,
be.
So is that just too specific of a location, and, right, and just take out the location and say, you know, at this point in time, I don't think we have that much information to say that.
City initiated that.
Mm-hmm.
That specific location.
And you'll have to talk a little.
That's correct. So it was our, it was the city that actually went out and acquired that property. Before we did that, if you recall, we had a memo from the chief that said that was fire chief that indicated that it would be a benefit for service and that we should certainly explore that. Now there was a significant amount of, it was like 46 acres of land, of which about 7 was developable for this potential public use. So the remainder is still a benefit because it's going to be land that'll be, you know, in perpetuity, I guess, down the road at some point when we finalize what the boundaries look like, that we'd be able to put in protected open space.
Other comments?
Yeah, I'd like us to reword. I don't have a suggestion, but that phrase in the middle of B, it says seek efficiencies, then it says hold down rising service costs. That we have a plan, we have a formula, it's part of an ILA. That frame, we're not suggesting changing that framework, but if we're looking for some type of kind of structural change, such as relocating a station to help us achieve the level of service we require at a better and a more cost-effective way, I don't like the statements hold down rising service costs, because I don't really think that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to do what we do better, more or better service for what we're putting into it.
Want to move on to growth management? Like this would come to Land and Shore.
I just had a question about the regional growth centers framework conversation. Shouldn't that be on here somewhere?
Yeah, absolutely. I was going to mention that same thing. That's actually an action that's happening in 2017.
Yep.
Yeah.
And should be identified. Is left.
Anything else?
I didn't know what the Ruckles House GMA wrote. I'm wondering under status if at Land and Shore there shouldn't be updates to Land and Shore on what we know about the what's going on at the state level. We don't have a forum right now where we're getting updates on their processes, their timeline, or where they are. Have an update. Dates at Land and Shore on that?
The GMA?
Yeah, the state level GMA review. I don't know anything about it.
Maybe the Regional Growth Center, too.
Who's the chair of that?
I don't know. Resigned.
She resigned?
No, I'm kidding.
Bummer.
Don't say that too long.
And one other thing about this, sort of regionally, we would absolutely are already planning. We budgeted for it in 2017 to collaborate regionally with Forterra for doing the focus groups.
Yeah, it is.
And the
service.
It's in the next.
It's in there?
Yeah, it's in there.
Oh, I think it's under environmental.
It's under environmental. Yeah.
I thought that was a weird spot.
Maybe
it
should be here.
Oh, okay. No, isn't it here? So my bad. I think that really is really
it's
not, is a
it's under A.
Under A.
Under status, the last one.
Oh, I was looking under actions. So I that's what I was looking for.
There.
Housing.
Yeah, let's go on to housing. Will that go to Land and Shore as well? I'm thinking it would. Okay. Comments about housing? It's proposed. Economic development.
Okay. So, one thought that I had that I thought would just be helpful, it's just a small thing, but when we're saying who the city representation is and when we're listing that if we could say what capacity those people are serving in. I think as a newer member to council, when you're trying to look at the regional strategies and you're trying to think about areas you might want to serve, it would be helpful because it just lists the name, but you don't know where they're serving.
Or what position.
Or what position.
Are they a chair or a member?
What? Which committee would you like the economic development goal to go to?
Services.
Okay. Environment? Sorry, Mariah, go ahead.
The other thing that I was going to say is that, so in regard to economic development, so we listed two things there. We listed Economic Development Council Board, we listed Workforce Development Council, but we didn't list Economic Development District Policy Board, the Puget Sound Regional Board. And again, when you're looking through this information and determining, you know, what areas you might want to serve or areas of interest, it would be helpful if all of those things were listed under partners and we're not missing any.
One thing I would say is that we do have a separate like spreadsheet matrix document of all of the organizations, who's serving on them and what their position titles are, and that actually includes more than what's in the regional agenda, because this is just like, you know, the few organizations that we're focusing on for the year.
Right.
So maybe what I could do is attach that as part of the regional agenda each year.
That'd be good.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, well, I think it was.
Maybe. It was last year. It wasn't included in this year.
And also, Maya, did it say whether or not our city representative was for our city or for SCA seat? Did we say that on the table?
It did in the matrix, yep.
Anything else on economic development, which will go to services and safety? Moving on to environment.
Where?
And insurer, probably?
Can you pull that? Thanks, Maya.
I don't know. Or wait.
I think if we looked at relevant.
Oh, let's look at the objectives. Oh, you all tell me.
Who's the next one, Maya, on environment?
We've got human services.
There's two more. Seems less.
And is there a C as well? Is there water resiliency?
Mm-hmm. Less.
Where would water resiliency? Where did it end up?
It didn't. Overall, I think this one's kind of, I'm not sure, it's missing stuff. I mean, one thing is Lake Sam Park, which is, you know, okay, but I don't see it really. Because they're becoming a leader in sustainable activities, I guess, like I was trying to get there, and Lake Sam being part being this, you know, one of two. Kind of light.
Light on what?
What we're really doing, become an environmental leader.
I think that's a great point, and I was looking at the, when we were talking about the goal one, transportation, one of the things that will be easy to overlook, and so I think the committees should also look at the actual goal statement, make sure that it says what we want it mm-hmm. to say, particularly after we begin tweaking, because mm-hmm. often you can tweak and then it doesn't mm-hmm. have the right statement. Okay.
Just a question, Maya. Do you remember where water resiliency is? Water, drinking water.
I believe we included it as part of the Greater Lake Sammamish Watershed item.
Oh, I mean the drinking water one. We Food have loss. Any? Because current.
Yeah. I was trying to use different language.
Well, yeah. Well, it's the Lower Issaquah Valley Aquifer.
It should be on here somewhere, yeah, isn't it? Oh, we don't have a seat. Yeah. Okay. No, awesome, seat. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because there's a lot going on there.
Okay, so you want environment going to land and shore, or sorry, Tola.
So I think it probably wants to live with services.
Okay.
I would like to request that when we are done with this, I think a lot of these are coming to services, and I'm happy to take those on, but I think that I should sit down with staff and sort of look at what we've got for the next couple of months and make sure we don't, I'm not sure we can put all of these on to one meeting. I think we should look at the effort estimate of it and see if maybe it's a multi-month effort in services, because I could see this taking a lot of these. You put enough of these together, and I think it's beyond even one. As much as I like long meetings, and I like them very much, you know, I think that more than 3 or 4 hours is unreasonable.
Yeah, it looks like it might be. Yes.
Yes, a lot of services.
Human services. Oh, look, that might go to.
I just ask that they don't all come back in April.
Schools.
Is my concern.
And schools.
There you go.
And schools. Okay.
Maybe we should just think about balance.
Yeah.
That way. Not on services.
Yes, we should think about that. So, okay, let's continue on and then we'll revisit that. Human services, comments for?
Services.
Services. For who else?
No comments on this one.
Okay, schools. Can you talk louder?
Or just turn.
So there's certainly partnerships set with nonprofits, and we've had conversations with the county about what senior services look like. So that could be an area if you wanted to touch upon that.
Well, it's a new service area. We're doing.
Is it a regional agenda item?
Yeah, that's my question as well. And because we are definitely partnering, we're engaging. It's not really any of these, but it's really with nonprofits.
Right.
Now there's not really with King County. It's not. We're not really engaging at this moment with the city of Sammamish.
I was going to say we could. There's an opportunity there that because there previously is around 10 to 15% of the membership there was from city of Sammamish.
Would maybe at least take a look at that and make a consideration.
Are you thinking under human services or its own goal area?
Under human services.
And I think that's a really good idea to add that. And I think that from a regional perspective, as we talk about some of the targeted funding and some of the losses to the senior community, this is probably something that we'll start to talk about. It really merges into a lot of the issues for the Eastside Human Services Forum, so I think that's a really good point.
So I'm not quite as clear on why that is an agenda item. But I will leave it to
I'm putting it out there. I agree with you that it has to rise to that level.
Because we work with regional partners all the time on things. I don't know that it necessarily, and they don't rise to the level of.
Sorry?
And they don't rise to the level of making it a
So regional agenda item. Again, I just know it's an area you're putting an investment in, and I'd welcome their administration's consideration as well. I mean, I agree with you, it may not, but staff investment, mm-hmm. I don't know the level.
Schools? Have any comments on this one?
I guess my only thought is it talks about coordination with the school, and I guess just from my experience, I don't see us having a really as good a coordination as we'd like to. And you know, it talks about an annual meeting, and we've been to one of those, and we share ideas and so forth. But how much we're really working together, I'm not so sure on this, and I've seen these things here, and I'm just, you know, a couple of code items here, but how much we're really looking at it overall, I'm not sure where to go with that, but it seems like we could better that coordination and communication.
So this is a subject that I have thought about a lot, because of course, as people know, I came up through the PTA side of the universe, and so had a lot of, continue to have a lot of connections into the district, and they're clearly a gigantic organization, much larger than we, with much more severe funding issues than we have, but it seems to me We have multiple fronts, right? I know that at least for a while, the mayor met on a regular basis with Superintendent Ron Thiele, right? And so that side of the relationship, I don't think we necessarily see as much, right? We have our meeting, our annual meeting with those guys, and it's complicated, of course, because they have a different engagement model for their board, right? They don't get as involved in direct issues as our council does. So it's comparing apples to oranges to some extent. But I don't know where the solution is, but I definitely get the sense that for as critical as our schools are to the city of Issaquah, and for as much as we, I think, go to great lengths to try to do things to support the district, I don't feel like the reciprocal relationship with the district is as strong as it could be. I don't know how we solve that. I think it's great that you and the mayor meet with Superintendent Thiele, but I don't know. I agree with you, Bill. It's not where I would like it to be. It's not as bad as some cities, because I hear horror stories, but it's also not as good as it should be, given how vital that relationship is.
Yeah, and actually there's a lot of interaction between the staff, so DSD, you know, various departments, and then also not just with central office, but also the actual school, so the elementary schools, middle school, high school, we have quite a bit of interaction with those other agencies. But what I kind of hear you saying is there's not much between the board and the electeds, between the various organizations. That could be partly because of the structure that you talked about, but maybe we had a great meeting last year on the urban schools. Maybe there's a way to enhance this next meeting that we've got this upcoming year with them to meet that same kind of goal and objective. There may be a joint city school committee. I mean, I've worked in a couple communities where we had electeds that served on, you know, from the school and the city, along with the chief, you know, the CAO, and the superintendent and the mayor or administrator that would serve on that. And they meet once a quarter just to find ways to coordinate better. So it may be an area that you may have an interest in or not, I don't know.
That could be a action item, explore.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Or the joint. Yep, Tola.
Yeah, just reminded, it's not on the work plan for 27. That's right.
But can it be on the agenda?
Can we capture just the concept? Does that make sense or not?
Or maybe it's something, I mean, if when we have a, hopefully if we do have a joint meeting, it's something that we can discuss as a group. I don't know that it has to be something that staff spends hours and hours and hours exploring.
Right. So one of the things I was going to suggest, given your comment earlier, that this could take a couple months or several months to finalize back out of committee, back to council, is maybe this is a biannual regional agenda. So it covers 2 years, because by the time we get done, it's going to be June. So, and that would enable us to capture a little longer period of time on some of the action items, and the pressure to get it done in within 2 or 3 months. So that would, on the school district one, we'd be able to encapsulate that at our annual meeting. We could throw that suggestion out there, and maybe it becomes an 18, a regularized meeting, you know, at that time. So if we spread the time frame out a little bit, maybe we could accomplish some of those things. Just a thought.
And I appreciate that Emily keeps reminding us about the work. We only have so many resources, and we need to do what we need to do well. So it's appreciated that you keep bringing that up.
That's a good cop job.
That's a good cop.
Just keep shaking your head like, No, Tola.
Just a closing thought on that. The thing about the last year's meeting was good. The urban schools conversation was good. But there again, the proof is going to lie in the pudding, right? If the district comes back, if the next high school is 40 acres and the next middle school is 30 acres and the next elementary school is 20 acres, then, you know, we'll look back and see that, you know, the communication won't have been set in as much as we'd like. So I think you're right. I think it was definitely, you know, there was a good exchange of ideas, but there's looming over all of it is, you know, they've got whatever. We're at, let's say, a 250-300 person organization in terms of FTEs, and they're whatever 1,200 or 1,400 or something like that. And again, with the horrific way that the state budgets are set up, right, they're perennially operating in emergency mode, and it gets a certain, you know, they have a certain moral sense because they are perennially deprived of money so severely that can make it hard to get them to engage us the way we'd like. But anyhow, thanks for letting me on along with that.
So I have that we have 8 goal topics. 5 are, looks like they would land in services and safety, 2 in land and shore, and 1 in CIC. So is there some other way of looking at that?
I think if we don't mind it taking 2 months to go through services, I'm fine with having those 5 come through services. I just don't want to have all 5 of them in 1 month.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes. Mariah?
One thing I was just going to ask, being on services, maybe we could do another red line with a different color just to capture what we talked about. I think that'd be really helpful.
Okay.
And I'm assuming in this that tomorrow doesn't count as one of the 2 months. I'm assuming the staff won't be ready to dive into this with us tomorrow afternoon in this room at 5:30 or 6:30.
So we're looking at April and May and then back to the full council in June. Okay.
Oh, no, sorry, never mind. You have your procedure.
So now we have to go back to appointments unless we have anything else. So that would come back to the council at one of the meetings in June is the, okay. So back to page 117 of the packet is the appointments language. So again, Bob and I worked on this, and it, I don't think there were many new suggestions. I think our thought, and chime in if I'm, I don't want to speak for Bob, but I think the goal here was to take, to accomplish a couple of things. One is to take our existing procedure for appointments and write it down and have that modified somewhat by a couple of things. One is taking in consideration the fact that we have a regional agenda. Then the next step is to how do we accomplish it? And one of the ways we accomplish it is by make sure that we assign resources in the areas where we're trying to accomplish something. And then the third one is who decides, just getting the procedure down. And in the case that there may be, you know, a tie to break or who actually has to make a decision, and I think in a lot of ways we like to rely on the process that we've had, which is the volunteer aspect, which is wonderful. And I think there's no real issue with relying on that unless we have 7 people who want to do things that aren't advancing our regional agenda, or we have more than one person that wants to do the same thing, be in the same position. So that's what some of the language addresses. The other thing I wanted is disclosure is I didn't place myself here as president, just so you know. I looked at it as anybody, the mayor or the council president, having to make these decisions at the end of every year, at the first of every year. So with that, feel free to, and Bob, you can add what you want.
Well, I think that was a great explanation, and you did a lot of the work on putting this together. I think the challenge is, so not all of the appointments, obviously, to the regional things are made by us. So all we do is submit an application. And mm-hmm. So one of the challenges is if we have competing applications from the same city, and Sound Cities in most cases makes those appointments, they don't consider competing applications. So the city's got to have a process if we got two people that have interest. And so that's where we came, we arrived at the council president making that ultimate determination. Now, the interesting thing is, what if the mayor has an interest in serving in one of the same committees that one of the council members wants to serve on? So one of the things, again, just for conversation, is the mayor would have a right of first refusal to serve on that committee first. And if they chose not to, then and obviously they'd be available for the council members. You may want to talk about that.
I kind of split the baby on a couple
of
these.
We did.
We did, because like, mayor wants a right of first refusal, but one of the proposals was if there was a competing applications, the mayor would decide. And I said, no, I don't think the mayor should decide right. where the council is going to be appointed.
Yep.
So it was a friendly negotiation. But here, but anyway, that's what I think. Yeah, it was yep. fun.
And the last item, and I don't know if I can't, I know we talked about it, but I can't recall if we specifically arrived on this or not, which was so we have certain committees we really need representation on to accomplish our agenda. And sometimes there may be no application from the electeds to serve on that. And so we may have some committees that you have a personal interest in, but it's not one of those. So I guess the question to the council was, you know, do you have to first fill out the opportunity to meet the regional agenda before you can apply for a committee that you may have a personal interest in, but doesn't meet the objectives of the city? I think we talked about it, but I don't know if we've resolved it, but we wanted to just put it out there for you, because that would be very different than the way the council and the mayor have operated in that conversation in the past.
And I think Bob would, I was joking when I said it was a negotiation because, you know, did work together. Bob, you know, drafted and I amended and then he amended and I amended. And so we ended up at something and I thought we were both, we are both comfortable presenting as the straw man. It wasn't anything that we thought, here, this is perfect. But we just wanted you all to have something that we thought was reasonable to start with. So that's how we got here. Make sure everybody knows.
So you've given us some good text to consider, but I think Bob also just threw something down here which is not on here, which is pretty significant. Did the two of you discuss that as well?
Well, we had a conversation.
And it sounds like, and you won, Stacy, because wanted it and you didn't?
We just didn't. We said we were going to bring it up at the meeting, but we didn't put it in on text.
So tell me what that, because I thought that was some of what you said was in here. What, tell me what you said.
It may be, it's getting late. But the conversation was, so the regional agenda drives your applications. What's the second to the last bullet? There it is.
Yeah.
Thanks.
It's on the next page.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's. I thought that was right there. It wasn't new.
Here, go. Look at this. Yeah. Look at these eight bullets. Okay. Oh, there's four more.
One question? So, actually, I like the language, and I don't really have any suggested changes to anything that's there. My one thing that I thought might be missing that we might want to consider is that what's in our regional agenda now is what we're doing, and we haven't done a gap analysis of, you know, what was the one that came up, Bill? The SBA appointment. TPP. Where do we want to be? So not only have we not said we're going to do sort of a gap analysis and strive to fill it, but is that like an annual retreat topic? Where do we want to be? What are we missing? Because
thanks for that. Thanks for bringing that up.
That's the only thing I didn't see here.
One of the things we talked about as well is, and I think you and I have talked about it, is that you have a regional agenda that you adopt at some point during the year, and so everybody knows where what we want to accomplish regionally, and so where we might like to have resources in what positions, or where we would like to assign resources and have focus our resources. And then somewhere around the first of every year, there are appointments to all those regional committees. And so at some point, either while the regional agenda is being passed, or maybe at an annual retreat, there is an actual discussion about where we need to seat people so that there's some sort of a least council buy-in about what positions we should be seeking at the end of the year, so there's a nexus between what's here and where we all maybe request to be, or maybe maybe even we reform the survey that we send out, just, you know, to ask everybody where they want to be. And that reflects, you know, not only our own committees, but our regional positions. I mean, that's one extra step we haven't talked about. But thank you for bringing that up.
There's an opportunity. So, for example, if we apply for a committee and we our council member doesn't get appointed to that, being on the SCA board for a couple of years, what I saw happen is that sometimes that non-appointee just goes to the meetings as an observer, and they build the relationships. Yes. And then when the appointment comes around the next time, they're like, well, you know, so-and-so has been at that meeting going for a year, even though they're not on the committee. And it actually helps your application for the next time.
That is an excellent suggestion. I love that. I just feel like there's other things we want to do, and we might have to do our homework to get there.
We are scheduled to have a retreat June 8th or 10th.
So speaking of homework, I think we might want to put something in here. You know, the last time there was an SCA appointment that we had multiple people that were interested in, it turned out that SCA felt that, like, in that topic, Issaquah was already well represented, so they wound up going with a city that wasn't represented in that field. So it seems like there might be something in here where we want to talk to representatives from AWC, King County, PWRC, and SCA as we're going to look at where we apply to understand where the perception of the unmet need is going into these things. AWC doesn't have many appointments, but they have a couple. And King County on things like GMPC and PSRC for GMPB and those sorts of things, so that we can understand where we're likely to have the biggest impact. And I think that's probably a mayoral level conversation with those organizations. But for instance, with Dow's, municipal representative, mm-hmm. which is Diane Carlson, you know, as an example, as we get into appointment season.
So your point on AWC actually just reminded me. So they have an opening on their board from our region, like right now, and it's a gap. So we don't talk about it on the regional agenda. It hasn't been part of the legislative agenda, but we could certainly help frame the state legislative agenda that AWC passes if we had a person on the AWC board. So if there was an interest, we haven't even talked about, you know, who would apply or what the process would be, or should we have someone that tries.
This is a great next step. This is great.
Yeah.
This is really good. This is great. Yeah.
So I think to make this flow, definitely on the regional agenda, we have to sit there and say, what do we want? Because then it's listed of these are the places we want to be, right? Mm-hmm. I think that's perfect. I'm looking at this, and I guess I'm just having a little bit of problem with it. Basically, you know, it says applications basically submitted and decided by the mayor for SCA.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
So it's a one person deciding, and other ones are also have mayor's first right of first refusal. And it seems like
No, wait.
Second bullet is everything in Sound Cities would be decided by the mayor.
Nope, just a public issues committee, just a pick.
Okay.
I do think it's a legitimate question. Is that by our custom, our practice, or is that required? Because I don't understand why it would be treated any other differently than any other regional committee, in that the council president would decide, or council would decide, I guess, sort of, with the council president making the decision about who gets slotted where. That's one of the questions I don't.
So we don't know if that's a requirement.
I don't know if it's a requirement or if it's, understood to be a mayoral appointment because the mayor transmits that application. And if you'll see down here, I'm taking your spot, but it says that the decisions, the applications shall all be transmitted to the regional agencies by the mayor's office, because we don't have staff, and so that we could keep consistent record keeping. So I'm wondering if it just ended up to be that the mayor makes that application. So anyway, go ahead. Sorry, I was going to just clarify.
So I'd like to propose something totally different than this, and that is that we work together as a council and mayor, sit down together and work this out of who goes for where. And because if everybody submits something, it's kind of like throwing it in a black box, and it's going to come back out. But if we sit down and talk about it, we may find that you really like this one, I kind of like this one, you know, let's get some things lined up and we can have some discussion and put it on the table. Who's got preferences, who's got particular skills, backgrounds? And I think it could be something we could all work on together and come up with a better solution of meeting, and we'll know what committees we're trying to get to, because that'll be already, you know, and so we'll work on those. And there's some people that obviously, like, you get on a committee, you want to stay on it for a while to build some tenure on pick, and not like, you know, if you're your third year on a committee, you want to build some of that stuff, so you don't want to give some of those things up when you've got that. And those kinds of things. I think we'd be better off than that. Then this feels just like a black box of, I put it in there and I'll put down my choice, 1, 2, 3, and no discussion. Someone has to make some assumptions on why I put 1, 2, 3, and sort those things out. Or I'd rather sit down with all of you and talk about it and say, who's best at this?
Yeah,
and figure that out.
I think that's a great suggestion. And I think, so there actually are conversations that go on, you know, like, you and I talked a couple times, and I talked to Tola, and I talked to Paul. You know, I'm not sure I talked to had any reason to talk to Mariah, because I didn't have any questions for her. So there are conversations that go on. I think, but I also think that you actually have to have procedures and tiebreakers, and you have to have decision makers. But I think I'm completely open to the step of, you know, talking at a retreat, for example, mm-hmm. each year. And kind of hashing it out, if you will.
City Samantha.
Yeah, after you have a survey, and which is the way City Samantha does it, too. I don't have any issue with that. But I think you do have to have procedures that are tiebreakers.
The model we propose is just the same way that your council committees are appointed, which is done by the council president. That's kind of what we fell back on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know,
if I may, so I do, Bill. I think that's a good suggestion, mm-hmm. and it speaks to implementation, which this doesn't. And if there was more of a group conversation, like Stacy just said, there does have to be some structure that we fall back onto. And I think and specifically on the first page with bullets, the third one. Seems to me, I don't quite understand that one, especially when you consider we explicitly, on the second page, the first bullet, they almost seem to overlap. The first one, I mean, so your page split a little bit different. One that starts with if two or more.
Right, mm-hmm. Go back down where you're there.
Is that one?
There it is. Yeah.
So if two or more count, so, okay, so that's basically saying if, you know, for whatever process we got there, the council is the final arbiter. The council president is the mm-hmm. final arbiter in which one
issue.
Should be transmitted. And that, you know, that makes sense. And I would think that, you know, it would be a very kind of thoughtful and thorough process prior to then, and hopefully it could be resolved without some type of final decision like that. So that makes sense to me. The other one, the third bullet, though, up above, says all other appointments of elected officials shall be decided by the council president. Where does that fit?
Like, what category you mean? What a position was that?
This idea decided. It seems
it may not be the right language.
Yeah, I'm not saying it well right now, but I mean, I know that there has been and there shall continue to be conversation. Maybe we'll even improve how we do that conversation. Mm-hmm. And it would be really great if kind of by consensus, you know, we could resolve this. To me, then, the only statement that needs to be there is when there is, you know, we go through that process and it's still not down to one, and then the president is the final arbiter.
Well,
that's the language that needs to be there.
The one you're talking about is, I mean, that's actually what we do now. Council president decides. Council president makes the assignments. That's what happens. Right?
Not on the regional ones.
Yeah, the list comes mm-hmm. out. The survey includes the regional ones. Now, everybody has self-selected. I don't know that we've had ever any issues about that.
Yeah, that's what I'm I think what we've done is self-selected. We've chosen to apply. When a couple of years ago when I applied to regional,
pretty much people self-select.
I didn't get appointed to it. I just applied.
The other way we could do it is, you know, it could be a vote. I mean, if you wanted to really decide who's going to be on what, we can vote on each one. I don't know.
Well, I mean, EFER's an example, right, where that's been contested, if you will, and the council president had to decide.
Mm-hmm. Bob?
Since, Paul, you were the council president at the time.
Quickly. So we have some time.
So the point is, like, really taking all these up, way that saying, you know, mayor or president, and saying it's a council mayor group, almost in executive session or something, if you want, you know, I don't know how they want to be or not, whatever, but.
Nope.
But the discussion of who goes where, and then if you can't come to group decision, consensus,
then you have a tie.
Then you have the president make the call. So it's a group decision. We're working as a group. It should be a group decision. So otherwise, sitting back going, I don't know, and all of a sudden you get something. It's like,
I like doing it at the retreat. Yeah. That's a great idea.
So I don't have any issues with that at all. I think if we got to that point, that'd be wonderful. There's also a timing issue. So you have to start coordinating all of this, because almost every year you're going to have also new council members. Or at least every other year. And so it's not as though we can have a June retreat and we can be all in line on maybe what we want to apply for and or fill out in the survey or whatever. So there needs to be some more thought about that too. Tola?
I think we also always have to take into account, what if we didn't have this sort of Issaquah civility, mm-hmm. right? We have cities around us that have blocks of votes, right? And leadership comes down to, you know, those blocks vote against each other, and somebody gets 4 votes and the other person gets 3 votes, and those schisms continue on in mm-hmm. how they operate. And we've been lucky enough not to have that. But if you had that, everybody would have to say, you know what, person X got 4 votes, and so they're in charge, and when there's a debate, you know, mm-hmm. they get to have the ultimate say. I think it's fine to come up with a process. I mean, speaking as a former council president who did this once, you know, I think it's fine to say, let's try to have a process where everybody can get more or less what they want. And you can have a conversation if you get to a point where you can't give people what they need. But I do think ultimately the reason we elect a council president is to adjudicate those sorts of things. So I think you can do both. I think you can say, let's have a process and let's take a time to talk about where there's these differences, and maybe even have people sort of give 60 seconds on why they want to do it, right? Have us audition for these things internally, and then. But I think ultimately you do have to have the council president make that decision.
No, that's a good. So I will say that we don't go. So how do I say this? There could be issues with that. There can be issues with deciding. At retreats, kind of mm-hmm. by block voting, who's going to do what? That can be an issue. Raya?
I actually like. I think that one piece that we were missing was sitting down and talking about the regional agenda ahead of time, and then talking about the different areas where maybe we need to fill some gaps and that kind of thing. But being able to sit down and do the survey, I actually like that part of it. But maybe then it could come back, and then after the council president sees the survey, and then we have an opportunity to say, you know, we've got a couple of areas where we've got two people that want to go for the same position, or we've got areas where we don't have any representation, because then it might solve itself in that mm-hmm. one of those people says, oh, I didn't know that, I'd like to go over there. So I think a big part of our process seems to work well.
What do you think about that? And sort of a intermediate survey, public discussion about where it looks like all the pieces are going to fall from the person who's going to do the assignments, and
You're looking at me, and I think I heard everybody say the exact same thing, so with slightly different words, which is we're going to put it on all on the table. The president's going to have final, you know, arbitration, if you will, but that everybody discuss it, see what fits best with everybody. We'll try to get everybody's, you know, desires as best we can, fill in all the Issaquah needs for sure first, and spread it out. And if something doesn't come to full consensus, then president has the you know, the final decision to settle any problems and go from there. And that will also, I think, then allow for, say, then we all have things covered, and then someone say, well, I want to do this, and it's not on the original agenda, and you go, everybody's got everything covered, so go for it, you know, and then that all gets settled at the same time as well. So I basically heard everybody say the same thing, and we're basically adding it, putting on the table for everybody to, I think, cooperatively work at the same time versus the president making a bunch of phone calls and back and forth and trying to talk, you know, it's just get together and do it and make it done.
I like the idea of revising the survey annually to reflect what what spaces we're looking to fill. Paul, did you have something?
I do. Excuse me. So the, again, it's slightly different in my document. That last bullet you have up there, it says all decisions shall be transmitted the appropriate authority by the mayor's office. And I just, as the council does not have staff in order to, and in order for consistent record keeping. So we're talking about pushing send on an email. So I don't quite understand that, because we fill out our own applications. Like SCA has a standard application form. Fill that out and you email it to SCA.
Yeah,
I wasn't really sure what this comment was supposed to
mean. Well, the comment was supposed to mean that council doesn't have staff, and I can tell you, as I'm sure you can attest and Tola can attest as well, there's a lot of work to do as council president, and so anything that I can do to help have staff help would be fantastic. And also, Tina is the one who keeps all the official records and sends out the official list of the appointments, and anyway, so.
Is it just a matter of copying on it then?
Yeah.
So
I just
the way I kind of looked at this was if one of you went rogue, what we could tell SCA is the only one. This is our process. The only ones that come from the city are the ones that count are the ones transmitted by the mayor's office.
We're so glad somebody thinks that way. Right. You know, there's a chance someone could get rogue.
Yep. That's why. So I mean, that's what we would tell the SCA director is, this is the application from the city, regardless of that council member submitting it, it didn't come from the mayor's office, and that's our process.
So we need to add consistent record keeping and in case someone goes rogue.
Exactly.
to we manage did not the rogue. That.
and the other thing to throw out is, this is great for the annual thing that happens, and then it seems like there's always some vacancies that show up somewhere a long time in the middle of the year. And those can kind of, you know, I don't think we're going to sit down and do this whole thing for that, but somehow some informal discussions and share that. For example, like, you know, Tola was on EMAC and he, you know, stepped down and no one applied. So, you know, Tola said, well, you want interested? And I said, oh, sure. You know, no one applied. So I jumped on it. Okay. But that's kind of, you know, those things will happen.
Well, we need to have that on here too. We need to add that. Vacancies during the year.
Vacancies
during that are not.
And so the only comment I would make on that takes some deliberative thought, because like when you applied, I can't remember, did you get on it?
Yeah, I did.
So now you're on how many?
Two SEA committees.
Okay. So then when a third one came up that may be more important, I know just as being, and it's not just for you, I'm not trying to point you out, but just in general, sometimes I'll be like, well, that person's already serving on two committees or three committees. We need to spread the wealth. So in that case, EMAC, while you applied, may not be of the utmost priority on the regional agenda, but you may damage your application for one that is important. So, I mean, I think it comes up to the council president to, you should still kind of run through that process.
Well, I think
if you have a broader interest.
Yeah, I think the process we would be looking at here is just, if there's an opening, if there's a vacancy somewhere and there's an opportunity, then that will be circulated to the council members who, you know, have a deadline kind of thing to apply. Is that what I was laughing?
Oh, no. I'm sorry.
All right, no disrespect intended. I'm just, we're as a council, we're spending an hour on process, and we didn't give much content. We're actually looking at the regional agenda. I was just reflecting on that. I know we're going to work on it some more.
So, anyway, yeah. Something that was missed on this list.
So a little less, kind of the same concept, but a little less formal, since it's probably only like one position or sometimes two.
Just make sure everybody
and see if everybody's interested, has the opportunity, and whatever conversations need to take place to see that. And yeah, and it's kind of where they will or not happen.
I was just going to say on the survey too, if we're going to revamp that, that maybe we could have the, you know, all of the primary and types of positions that we would be focusing on for the regional agenda, and then maybe a secondary tier, and that way people could say, once all of those are filled up, then you could say, I'm also interested in this.
Mm-hmm. One thing too, and I can't remember who brought it up, I think this year, that the survey should include when those
Meeting times,
so that dates, we know
what we're signing up for.
Right.
Third Thursday, 4:00.
Mm-hmm. But those are all in the handbook, so.
Oh, for
SCA
and other ones. Yeah, but there's other ones on our list that we don't have on there.
Just guessing that they might be old.
Some of them were different.
Yeah.
And not really updated.
Yeah.
That was my take on it.
What?
Oh, I just want to say, Stacey, I just want to say thank you for doing this conversation for this last hour, because I feel that we put a lot of thought into our how we reach out regionally.
I think we do more than most cities. I think there's a couple other cities that do conflict.
Not but on.
There you go. What great microphones. Oh, now it is working. Okay, wait. Now it's working. I guess it takes some time. I want to say thank you for having this conversation this last hour. I think that as a city, we put a lot of thought into our regional outreach, how we connect outside the city. And I think that's how a city of our size gets the kind of influence that we want to have in regional questions. So there are a couple other cities that also have put this much thought into it, but I think it's really important. So,
good.
Thanks.
Just give me 1 minute.
So we're going to go to committees, and then back in June, and then the appointments. I guess we'll want Bob and I to kind of take the thoughts that we heard and was a second draft.
Track changes,
that'd be
great. Okay. Now, I too wanted to add, I'm really glad that you wrote it down. I think this is, we didn't have it before. Mm. So this will be really good, and so I appreciate the work, and I think it's only going to be better. And,
good.
And the only one kind of logistical point I haven't heard, maybe you intended it earlier, I mean, with this, having the original agenda done, but sometimes, and every other year, we may have to wait to after November actually do the huddle because we don't know who that's going to be on the council the next year. And then that is also very close to when the application times come,
right,
especially for SCA. So that has to be, that is just, we just have to be aware of that tight window that we have to fit within.
And we're buried with budget at that time. Yeah.
Well, hopefully we could be mostly done by that. Yeah, 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 yeah. No, you're right. That could, that actually is a big opportunity to overlap as well.
Yeah, one of the things that, we've talked, over the 4 years that I've been on leadership, or this is the fourth, one of the things that we get better at each year is planning, and planning with the administration about planning ahead. And so that's, I think, the regional agenda, and whether it will be annual or biennially, and how we coordinate that with elections and budget and legislature, and I mean all those things we have to consider. I think every year we get a little bit more thoughtful, and this is one where we have to, we may even evolve that council leadership annual calendar to a form that lists all the things that we need to do and start getting on the calendar by January, because it, by January you kind of let your breath out. You go, oh man, no, I don't know that I can deal with this again until March. And then all of a sudden it's March, and we have a lot of things we have to get on the calendar. So we have we can be more thoughtful. So we'll work on another iteration. So that's, I know. That's all we have on the regular agenda, and I know we have, I know Mary Lou has something that she wants to discuss briefly, and then you, Emily, you have something as well. But Maya, we can't forget Maya.
Thanks, Maya. Thanks, Maya.
Maya, thank you very much for working
thank
on
you.
The regional agenda.
Thank you, Maya.
And we ended up having kind of a internal work session discussion here.
I captured your notes.
You captured it all.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so mine ties a little bit into the regional agenda, and that is that I sort of share some of the sentiments that Mariah said. When you come onto council, you don't understand much about what this regional role is. You come and sit at council meetings and watch, and you hear the business of the city, but not so much understanding you also have this regional piece. And I feel like since I've come on a little over 3 years ago, it's really evolved from being something you might also want to do to something you're strongly encouraged to do. So we're going to have a council goal to say we're going to actually write an agenda. And I just wanted to share one piece, and I know we're not going to do it this year, but when I look at the regional agenda now and I see how it's changed over the last two or three iterations, it's great. But there is a aspirational piece that I have that somehow out of our regional agenda, we produce something like AWC produces, which is, theirs is a pocket legislative guide, and I have a copy for anybody who wants it, but it's something that when we're out in the community, not just the representative on a certain appointment or, you know, we do get regional report outs, but every single council member understands what the talking points are for everything that we have on our regional agenda. So if you haven't seen this before, the AWC card, take a copy. I think it's really, really well done. We probably don't have, well, we do not have the resources to get this far this year, but that's where we can be in a year or 2 years or 3 years, is where we're all out there and we have our common talking points, whether we're talking about Metro or we're talking about what are you doing right now?
Anything.
The GMPB, the regional growth center framework. But we all know and we can all speak to it, not just that particular council rep who's been doing it for 1 year or 4 years or 5 years or six, but all of us can talk similarly. So just an example of where I think we can be next year or the year after, just more power in the community when we all have the same talking points on the same regional item. So that was it. Thanks.
Thank you. Thanks. Emily?
Great. Thank you. I am going to
handouts.
Great. Enthusiasm, pass out little cards. There are different motifs, so you can take one of each. You could decide that you really like card number two better than three and take more of that one. Do as you like. But these are little cards that encourage people to fill out our park and trails
nice.
Planning survey.
Nice.
And I believe they have the
these
website
are hot
on them.
Off the press. These are hot off the press.
Yes, hot off
today.
The press. So they direct everyone to the project webpage, and there you can
Fantastic.
Find the survey. In addition to that, you can also find out that we have six upcoming community workshops. We call this first phase Listen and Learn. And community members and all of you as council members as well can attend one or more of those workshops. We have them located in different areas of the city, but they all begin at 6:30 p.m. and they're on dates March 21st, 23rd, 27th, 29th, and April 4th and 6th.
Awesome.
So I encourage everybody to take many of those cards, pass them out to everybody you know, encourage them to go to the website, find out more about this whole planning effort, and to take part in it.
Where else Christian. Will we see them in the community?
Excellent question, and I don't know the answer.
Okay.
Lots of places.
Because I'm going to try to go to a number of those. Are we going to have, if more than three of us show up, do we need to do anything about that? Or
why don't you just send Tina a quick note, letting her know that that's your intention.
Are these meant to pass out to people in the community?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Just making clear.
Yep. And if at some point you need more, contact Jeff, and he can find out if we have more to distribute.
It's the same information,
yeah.
Just different pictures. Really important.
I want the feet.
Yeah, the feet.
Our baby feet.
Oh,
okay.
True.
That's it. All right. If we don't have anything else, then we're adjourned. Thank you, everybody.
Does anybody want more? There's lots more.
Yes.